presentation of the SoCon Sports Network.
Georgia Southern stayed atop the national polls last week with a down-to-the-wire 28-27 win over Chattanooga. The play of the game was this stop by Josh Rowe when the Mocs went for two in the upset win.
And Georgia Southern's defense stands tall.
Today, the leading passer in the Southern Conference, Furman's Chris Forcier, has upset on his mind as he leads the Paladins into Statesboro for the SoCon Game of the Week.
Of the Southern Conference Game of the Week returns to Statesboro, the site of the number one ranked team in the country and the top scoring team as well. The undefeated Georgia Southern Eagles hosting one of the surprise teams in the Southern Conference in the early part of the season, the Paladins of Furman. Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us on a warm yet windy afternoon in Statesboro. I'm Darren Goldwater. This is Doug Chapman, a former Marshall University running back. We'll be joined by Stephanie Singleton and Rashawn Ali later on in the broadcast. This game, though, isn't just about the two teams this year. It's a game that dates back the rivalry to 1985.
Back to 1985 when they first met in the national title game. They met again in 1988. You said it right. This is a rivalry. Furman has come to Statesboro the last two times and beaten the Eagles here at home. So the number one ranked Eagles definitely know they have their work cut out for them today.
In fact, the last four meetings between these teams have been won by the road team. If Furman hopes to continue that trend, Doug, it'll rest a lot on the shoulders of their quarterback, Chris Forcier.
Yeah, Chris Forcier, extremely accurate passer. He's completing 70% of his passes and get the job done throwing the ball and running it. Last week versus Samford, had over 300 yards passing, also threw three interceptions, but can be very explosive throwing the football. Threw seven touchdowns versus Presbyterian earlier. Dual threat quarterback, not as mobile as Terrell Robinson, who we saw last week from UTC, but can get the job done with his legs.
Forcier also matched a Furman record in total yards last week in the loss to Samford. While Furman is a balanced team, Doug, Georgia Southern gets it done predominantly on the ground, and their leading rusher is Robert Brown.
They do it one way, and that's running the football. Robert Brown, the reigning offensive player of the week in the Southern Conference, 178 yards last week versus UTC here in Statesboro. Very, very physical runner. They come out, nothing fancy. You know what they're going to do. Robert Brown spearheads that rushing attack. They're going to have a lot of success on the ground today to beat this Furman football team.
Georgia Southern will try and remain atop the national polls, stay perfect on the year with a visit from the Furman Paladins. That is our Southern Conference Game of the Week. It's coming up next.
In Statesboro, and another fantastic crowd is expected. The fan base has been rejuvenated for the last couple of years, and they've got a rivalry with Furman as we check in with the third member of our crew, Rashawn Ali.
All right, thank you so much, guys. You know, the last eight meetings between Furman and Georgia Southern have been decided in the final minute or seconds of the game. Just last year, Jabo Shaw capped off a 15 unanswered point fourth quarter with a four-yard touchdown run to seal the deal, 32-20 out. Now, these games come down to the wire, and I'm expecting the same thing here today. Darren?
Rashawn, Jeff Monken said that's what makes not just this game but college sports great, the rivalries that are fueled. That is Bruce Fowler, the first-year head coach of the Furman Paladins, and similar to Jeff Monken, he has long-standing roots with Furman. Unlike Monken, Fowler actually graduated from Furman. Then he was an assistant for a long time before going to Vanderbilt. Now he's here with the Paladins. Meanwhile, Jeff Monken is in his second year now, and all he has done is lead Georgia Southern to victories in 11 of its last 12 games dating back to last year. They're atop the national polls. They had a scare last week, Doug. We'll see how they bounce back. We'll see how they improve off of last week's win.
Whether you win or lose a football game, teams can learn something from that, and I'm sure that they definitely learned something. The change of pace quarterback comes in last week, and they saw a little bit of Totero Robinson. Coleman goes down, but today I guarantee they're ready for this Furman football team.
Billy Greer, a senior who handles the kickoff duties, he transferred in from Blinn College, where he was a teammate on the national championship JUCO team with Cam Newton a few years ago. We'll put Furman on the 20-yard line to begin the game. Furman comes into the game with a 3-2 record. They're 2-1 in the league. It gets tough for them now, though. They have faced the middle to the bottom portion. Georgia Southern also getting set to face the tougher part of its schedule. They got past Chattanooga last week. They still have to go to Appalachian State and to Wofford before things are all said and done. He started his career at UCLA. Now Chris Forcier is having a breakout year as a senior with the Paladins. An incredibly high pass efficiency. His 15 touchdowns and opposite just 3 interceptions. In fact, he's climbing the charts. Most touchdowns thrown in Furman history. He's only 7 away. And this is Jarodis Williams, among the nation's leaders in yards per game. He gets 4 up to the 24. The line that paved the way for Jarodis Williams, led by the third-year starting center, Daniel Spizak, a co-captain with the most experience on the offensive line. The backs and receivers led by Jarodis Williams, who averages 111.8 per game. That is 14th best in the country. Colin Anderson is an excellent tight end. Not only a rivalry game, but two of the most storied programs in Southern Conference history. Furman has the most wins in league history as Jarodis Williams plows his way across the 30 for a first down, a gain of 7.
He picked up 7 on that play, but it was an excellent block thrown for him off the edge.
It's a good rushing defense for this Georgia Southern team, led by the 4 down linemen, in particular Brent Russell in the middle, a redshirt junior and a preseason All-American. Leading tackler is Darius Eubanks, while Rowe is coming off a season best in tackles. Ron Scott, the corner, the active leader for interceptions in the Southern Conference. Experienced offensive line that did not have its best day last week against Samford, but this time getting to the second level is Williams, another gain of 5 yards before Josh Rowe makes the stop.
You know, we know Georgia Southern likes to run the football. We know what Chris Forcier can do with his arm, but this opening drive for Furman, they've come out and they have shown they want to establish the run. And with a running back like Williams back there, they can do that. So far on this drive, they've kept the ball on the ground. They haven't thrown the ball yet.
Bruce Fowler said he just wants to be a balanced football team. It starts on the ground. It's not just Williams. They've got 3 backs who can really do some damage, including a fullback, Tesso Uha. Although Uha did not get that carry. Instead, it was Tony Caldwell, just the 5th carry of the year for him. 2-yard gain. It'll be 3rd down and short.
Georgia Southern is going to blitz this Furman football team. They brought pressure from the edge. It was a run call and through the middle. Good job by Georgia Southern's interior lineman to stifle that run, but they're going to bring corner blitz and blitzes off this edge to test these offensive linemen for Furman.
The freshman, Hank McLeod, is the deep back in the eye. On 3rd and short, they'll try him, and he'll lunge, needing the 41, will come up a yard shy. Westbrooks came up from his strong safety spot to make the stop.
And we talked about how tough they are on that interior of Georgia Southern, and this is guys just not staying blocked. Short yardage situations, you got to come off your block and make a play. They do just that. Hold firm and forcing in the punt.
It'll be Chaz Short to punt. He has struggled this year punting, and Darian Robinson to return, and on cue, he'll shank one, which will roll dead inside of the 35-yard line, but not one of the better efforts for Chaz Short, who's averaging only 34 yards a kick this year. That one just 25.
Now, you don't want to give this Georgia Southern offense a short field at all or good field position, which they have right here. We saw last week their ability to quickly strike even by running the football. So when you give them a shorter field, that's definitely in their favor.
Jabo Shaw, a senior quarterback whose brother Connor starts for South Carolina for the 2nd straight week, had one of his best career days last year in a win over the Furman Paladins. And it's worth noting that it's Dominique Swope who has the opening carry, not Robert Brown, the freshman fullback who filled in very well a few weeks ago at Elon. In fact, he was the Southern Conference Player of the Week a couple of weeks ago. As we get a look at the offensive line, all of them return. Brett Moore, the right tackle, a preseason All-American. One of the better offensive lines in the league. J.J. Wilcox,
an all-around player. Robert Brown, the leading rusher. It's a gain of two for Dominique Swope on the opening carry, and he stays in there. But Jay Boshaw pulls it. Jay Boshaw pitches out to Jonathan Bryant, who wiggles his way free for a first down across the 45.
And that's a good thing that they do here at Georgia Southern is they work you with that little B-back give. And just like that, he pulls it out of the B-back's gut. Shaw pitches it out, gets it to one of his players in space, and you see Bryant just does the rest. With this spread style of option attack, you never know who's going to end up carrying the ball. They have so many effective ball carriers, and they can spread it around. It's very, very dangerous, and it may look simple, but very complex offense to defend.
And because they have so many different guys who can touch the ball and stay fresh, they can have a very fast pace to their offense. Again, it's Jonathan Bryant. It's Kadarin Anderson on the stop. The active leader in tackles in the Southern Conference. That is his 317th career stop, playing behind a defensive line in a 4-3 anchored by Rodgers and Keg in the middle. Rodgers is 288 pounds. Anderson just pointed out, leading active tackler in the league. And Ryan Steed, the cornerback, might be the best NFL prospect in all of the Southern Conference. Georgia Southern can keep up the pace. It is something Samford did very effectively. This is J.J. Wilcox, a first down run down to the 34-yard line.
You know, what Georgia Southern does so well with this spread option is it's exactly that. They spread you out pre-snap. So when you see Shaw, he pulls it out of the B-back. He picks it to Wilcox. By the time he gets it, there's already natural running lanes created. So you have a talented back like Wilcox. Once he gets into the secondary, he can make things happen. But this type of attack, it creates running lanes when they're running that option. And as soon as that ball is snapped, you get talented athletes in space. That's how big plays happen.
They call him Big Play J.J. He averages nearly 11 yards per touch for his career as Swope works down to the 30-yard line. He was tackled there by Sean Boone. A relatively small defensive end, number 90, just 224 pounds.
And we have not seen Robert Brown on the field yet this entire drive. I'm not sure if he's nicked up or if he's got something going on, but he has yet to take the field this afternoon.
Pointed out that Swope started for him a couple of weeks ago. And it was because he had a little bit of a bruised knee, even though he didn't start, he still ran for over 100 yards. And last week, Brown, who's not on the field, tied a career high. This is Jarek McKinnon's first carry of the game. Cuts it back inside for a first down. Jarek McKinnon, a 12-yard run, is a guy who can do it in all phases of the game. Earlier this year, a rushing, passing, and receiving touchdown. First player since Jason Foster in 04 to have scored in all three different ways. Broke his hand a couple of weeks ago and is still playing with the club on the right hand, but he doesn't have any trouble catching that pitch. Boone chases him down and brings him down at the 10.
And they've got a lot of really good running backs, but McKinnon, to me, is their special back. He's the guy that can take it the distance, and he's got what the NFL likes to call wiggle. When you see these guys in space, they can make people miss. You see him get north and south right here, makes a defender miss. He's the most elusive out of all of their runners, can break you down in space. You see he can throw it, he can catch it, and he can also run it. Very, very dangerous football player.
And the Eagles are very dangerous in the red zone. Georgia Southern is ninth nationally. They have scored 25 of 27 times in here. It's second down and short. And it'll be enough for a first down to the 5, as Dominique Swope, the freshman from Buford High School in Georgia, moves the chains.
Once they get down here, it's a heavy dose of that B-back. They don't like to go east and west once they get this close to the end zone. They like to go north and south. Jay Boshaw will actually keep it. Get in the end zone often.
And often in the red zone, 74%. He's the epitome of efficiency. Something
you might hear a lot about today, efficiency. Both of these teams, 1-2 in passer efficiency, as Colton Keg will make the stop at the line of scrimmage, bringing up second down and goal.
Curious to see how this Furman front, not the biggest front, the very active linebackers, I really want to see how they play well down here when it's those short yardage situations, goal line situations, where they know the run is coming and they have to be very, very firm up front. Really interested in seeing how they protect this, their end zone against this option attack this afternoon.
It's the 10th play of this Georgia Southern drive. A good start for them would certainly be one step in the right direction. They have been close early in a lot of their games. Shaw gives it off to Wilcox. Touchdown, Georgia Southern.
And just like that, that big blue machine marches the football down the field, caps it off with a run by J.J. Wilcox. Shaw just pulls it out from his B-back. They make it look so easy. When you've got playmakers and you run that style of offense, if a defender is out of position, this is what can happen. You have a guy running scot-free straight through the running lane, walks in untouched. Wilcox touchdown.
Fourth rushing touchdown of the year for Wilcox. Now Adrian Mora, who could set an FCS record today with a couple more consecutive extra points, boots through his 124th consecutive extra point, capping off the touchdown drive of 10 plays and 66 yards, and the top-ranked team in the land is on the board first. That is how you start a football game. An impressive scoring drive, and here it is.
Furman gives them a short field to work with. You can't do that against Georgia Southern. And they make it look so easy. It's like clockwork. They march the football down the field. You see Shaw gives the pitch to Jonathan Bryan. He does the rest. Fakes to the B-back once again. Gives it to McKinnon off the left side. Makes a couple guys miss. Very dangerous runner in space. Gets it down. And then they do it the same thing the other direction. The pitch to Wilcox. He walks into the end zone. When they get to that part of the field, they score touchdowns.
And that's one of the reasons why this Eagle team is the number one team in the country. I mean, that right there, you saw it all. You saw the variety of different backs in that 10-play drive. You saw the efficiency in the red zone. You saw great blocking up front and the defense, which got them the ball in the first place.
And you hit it right on the head. Championship teams do this. When the defense holds the offense and they give their offense the ball, they give their own offense the ball back with great field position, the offense capitalizes. That's exactly what Georgia Southern did. Defense goes out, holds Furman, gives them the ball back with great field position. They march the field, march down the field, end up getting a touchdown. That's why they are the number one team in FCS right now.
And Doug, something goes overlooked a lot, the importance of special teams. It is a strength of Georgia Southern, and it is a trouble spot right now for Furman. And a 25-yard punt helped pave the way for that drive as Cedric Cunningham gets a seam up across the 40. Look out! Cedric Cunningham is gone! Touchdown Furman. No flags. 95 yards.
And right on cue, as we're talking about special teams and the importance that it plays in a football game, it's the third phase. You have offense, you have defense. This is the third phase of the special teams. And what better way to respond to a drive like Georgia Southern just put down your throat than to turn around and take it back to the house 95 yards. Mr. Cedric Cunningham said, okay, you want to run it down in a few plays? I'll take it all the way back in one play and try to tie this football game up.
Great early. And there's the kicking, and it's blocked. Again, right on cue. Georgia Southern scoops it up. It's LaRon Scott. Give the Eagles a couple more points.
Well, this game's not short of excitement, is it?
None. But right back to the kicking game. Cunningham may have had a career-long return, but this kicking game has been killing the Paladins.
Well, we've been on special teams these last 5 minutes, and just as we're talking about it, extra point, which is one of, you want to say, the easiest plays in football to do. It's supposed to be, but not today. Scott, they get through, block it, Scott takes it back, and now it's 9-6.
How about that? Georgia Southern and LaRon Scott, he's turning into one of their big play guys. He has been for a long time, preseason All-American. He's one of the best corners in the league and the active leader in interceptions, but this time he scoops up the loose ball. And we talked about Furman's kickers, Doug. They've been going back and forth between Ray Early and Chai Short because they just can't find consistency.
They can't find consistency, and you know, you saw it in the short punt, which gave Georgia Southern a short field, which led to a touchdown. But then you also go, we talked about stay on special teams. The kickoff return for a touchdown. And then the block field goal. Three big plays this early in the game that were sparked by special teams.
And when you're playing the top team in the country, and you're about to tie them up, and then you give them a three-point lead because of it. Here's Darian Robinson, and Robinson has a little bit of room. In the back of my mind, I'm thinking, could this really happen once again?
Back-to-back kickoff return.
Robinson, whose older brother is Dante Robinson, who's playing in the NFL and starred at South Carolina before that. Listening to the Georgia Southern postgame show as we were driving out of here last week, they put a lot of emphasis on the fact that this Furman team is their rival. This is the team that when you go back in Furman history, it's not Appalachian who's the team right now in the fans' eyes who aren't part of the Georgia Southern fan base. These two clubs, Furman's won 12 Southern Conference championships all time. They're the all-time winningest Southern Conference team. And it's Georgia Southern who leads the country right now. It's Lang on the stop of Shaw, 1 yard.
And you talked about it. We talked to Coach Munkin this week, and he said every team, you have to have a rival. You know, you have to pick someone out on your schedule who that's who you have to beat every year. And it's not always who the fans may think it is. But if you go back in the history of these two teams, you understand why they are rivals. Going back to the 80s especially, when they met in the national title game twice. And ever since then, and also they've beaten Georgia Southern here the last two times they've been down here. So I would definitely consider them their rival.
We touched on some similarities between the two head coaches earlier. Jonathan Bryant takes a well-pitched ball and gets out of bounds after a first down run. Greg Worthy pushed him out. Doug, he waited, Shaw did, until the last second, and that opened up the outside.
And that's what a lot of times these quarterbacks in this offense have to do. You sacrifice your body. You may take a big shot. You know you're going to, but that's for the play to be a bigger play. You hold that ball, you suck that defender in, and you let it go. Get it to your speed guys on the perimeter. Jonathan Bryant does the end, does the rest.
Haven't even gone to the air once. They lead the country, averaging 375 yards a game on the ground. That's something the Southern Conference is getting used to as Swope gets up to the 49-yard line. Kadarin Anderson on the stop. Doug, a Southern Conference team has led the country in rushing 7 out of the last 10 years. On pace to do it again.
Well, we've got a handful of teams that like to run that option down here. So you have an option attack, and you see that. The distribution of plays, 13 runs versus 0 passes. When you run it that many times and you're effective, you're going to lead the nation in rushing.
Swope remains in as the B-back. We still have yet to see Robert Brown. And this is J.J. Wilcox getting a block from Jonathan Bryant, his former high school teammate. It frees him for a first down run down to the 40, inside of it, 11 yards.
And J.J. Wilcox is a guy who in a lot of other offenses would be a wide receiver. He has a nice long frame, good size, over 6 feet, 215 pounds. But in this offense, he's a running back. They throw it to him often, but he does this very, very well. He can get on the edge of the defense, make guys miss, and he's big enough to run over top of you. He's a very, very dangerous weapon in this Georgia Southern offense.
Wilcox and Bryant, the duo from Cairo High School in Georgia. They've been a big part of this first quarter success for Georgia Southern. It is the Eagles' second drive. They scored on a 10-play 66-yarder. The first time they touched it, it was Wilcox who had the score. And with a flag down behind the play, Greg Worthy takes down Wilcox. First time we hear from Ted Pitts.
Morning. Number 88 on the offense. That's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay, first down.
Tyler Sumner, the junior tight end. Doug, we talked about it a lot last week. The guys on the outside, tight end, receiver, sometimes you'll see these tight ends split out wide in the option. Anytime you're rushing the football, these guys need to block well, and that's another reason why Georgia Southern is leading the country in rushing.
Oh, you have to. They very rarely get holding calls, but you said it right. The tight ends and receivers know their job is going to be blocking downfield.
Shaw to the air for the first time. It's Jonathan Bryant. Bryant's out of bounds inside of the 15. They'll put him right at the 15-yard line. And it's Nathan Wade who stopped him, 17 yards.
And that's what being able to run this offense. They can run the option out of the shotgun. And you see Shaw in the shotgun formation. You're thinking run. He rolls out. They give you a little run action. And then Bryant's into the flats wide open, picking up big yardage. That's the thing about this offense is when they want to throw it, a lot of times you'll see a receiver running scot-free in the secondary.
Now we get a look at Robert Brown. He is in as the D-back. And he is a decoy for Jarek McKinnon around the outside, tiptoeing his way, but out of bounds. And it was the free safety Worthy who knocked him out and prevented the touchdown.
And McKinnon has scary ability. He's the type of guy that if he's always one missed tackle away from taking it to the house, very, very explosive football player, even with the cast on his hand, to still get the job done.
Already in the first quarter, 107 yards on the ground. Now Jarek McKinnon will take a snap. Likely not a threat to throw with the wrap on his right hand. Furman knows it, but McKinnon goes right at him. It'll be first and goal.
You know, with as talented as that guy is, I wouldn't be surprised if he tried to raise up and throw it with the cast on, but they put him in that wildcat or wild eagle formation and takes a direct snap, picks his way down. And they've marched the ball now down to the 2-yard line. And you know what they do when they get this close to the end zone.
Maybe it is Robert Brown time. So many different weapons. We've seen a lot of them in the first quarter for Georgia Southern. And it's Jabo Shaw in for the Georgia Southern touchdown.
And they just make it look so easy offensively. They make it look like very effortlessly. They march the ball down the field on your defense, and you know they're going to run it, but you can't stop. You see Shaw just keeps it nothing fancy, pulls it out, goes over the left side, gets into the end zone. They just march the ball. They eat up clock, and they keep your offense on the sideline, which can definitely take you out of rhythm.
21st career rushing touchdown for Jabo Shaw. And Adrian Mora now one extra point away from matching the FCS record of 126 consecutive extra points. Not often you really highlight these extra points, but it's worth it there. Georgia Southern tacks on another score. They haven't been stopped yet. Jabo Shaw talking about the scoring drive, and Doug will tell us about it right now.
And like I said, they do it the way they want to do it, and that's running the football. You see Jabo picks it to Wilcox, takes it over the right end, picks up good yardage. He rolls out with that running ability. The linebackers are always frozen when Jabo Shaw is the football, which allows running backs to get to the flat. You see there, Bryant gets to the flat, picks up big yardage, and Jabo Shaw finishes it off, goes over the left end for a touchdown.
They've gone 66 yards in both of their scoring drives. This one play shorter than the opening drive for Georgia Southern. And Jeff Munkin, the second-year head coach, who was on staff when Paul Johnson was directing this Georgia Southern team to national prominence. Yeah, his team in pretty good shape. Now Cunningham, who went 95 yards his last time, has to continue here. And Cunningham will lunge up to the 12. Let's take a look at the Southern Conference scoreboard. Appalachian State did not start DeAndre Presley at quarterback. Jackson got the start today. And Jackson faring well at the Citadel. 35-14, Appalachian leads, non-conference for Wofford, and a big game for Elon and Samford, both teams in the middle of the pack right now. The nation's leader in pass efficiency hasn't attempted a pass for Bruce Fowler's offense. And they'll keep it on the ground. Nothing doing for Furman. Stacked up quickly by Josh Gebhardt, among others.
And they're going to have to establish some type of passing attack. Georgia Southern is extremely athletic on defense. And you're going to get a couple yards here and there, but you're not going to be able to line up and just run the ball down their throats. 4CA and company are going to have to dial up some plays here to get that ball out and test the secondary of Georgia Southern.
Last week, Samford limited Furman to a season-low 71 yards on the ground. They averaged just shy of 200. A big disparity last week in the loss. Maybe something to do with the fact they fell behind early. Now Forcier, the dual-threat quarterback, will drag players across the 15-yard line. Eventually, it's Blake Riley who will be credited with it. 6 yards on the run.
You know, we saw last week the problems that a mobile quarterback gave Georgia Southern. I don't think they were prepared for that. I think they are prepared for Forcier today. Like you said, he's yet to attempt a pass, which I find a little odd with the way he can throw the football, but looks like Coach Fowler and company are determined to come out and run this football. They want to establish some type of run and be, like he said in his call, we talked to him this week, he wants to be balanced. And I think he's trying to come out and prove that point early in this football game.
Third down and four. This crowd was a factor at points last week against Chattanooga, and they're going nuts now. Furman calls a timeout just before the play clock expired. They've been promoting it all week that it's a blue out here at Paulson Stadium.
There's a lot of blue in this crowd.
And it is tough to win here, Doug. Georgia Southern perfect atop the standings. Are we headed towards a showdown with Wofford late in the year for the Southern Conference?
It is looking like that, but the quarterback change there in App State, you never know. They may start to surge a little in the next few weeks. You never know what's going to happen there in Boone.
Georgia Southern still has to play them and Wofford. And you see Samford right there below Appalachian at 1-2. They beat Elon today. They're up early. We saw that. That's a Samford team that was impressive in the win over Furman. We'll see Samford later in the year. And even Bruce Fowler said it, that last week they just didn't respond well to the pace and overall just didn't play very well against Samford.
You know, from talking to him, he basically said we just didn't make enough plays. You know, football is about making plays. You have to be in the right place at the right time, but guys have to make plays. The guys that make enough plays last week.
Will King on the reverse. King will not have enough for a first down. He was pushed out by Darius Eubanks, the leading tackler. He's the junior from Harlem, Georgia.
And I understand wanting to establish the run. I understand wanting to be balanced, but as an offense, you have to know where your strengths are. You have a quarterback like Chris Forcier completing over 70% of his passes, threw over 300 yards last week versus Samford. Let him air the football out. They haven't thrown a pass yet this afternoon.
It's hard to believe. We've said it now a couple of times. It's still hard to believe. There's a minute left in the quarter. Jazz Short, who had a 25-yarder his first time. This one is excellent. Great hang time, but Robinson elects not to call for a fair catch and pays the price as Cortez Johnson drills him.
He's making up for that last punt he kicked. Puts his foot in this one, 47 yards on that punt, and boy, that's a great job by cornerback Cortez Johnson on special teams, running down, allowing no return. Love to see that from your special teams guys.
Talked a lot about the struggles in the kicking game. Chaz Short has the ability. He was one of the best kickers in the league a few years ago. It has been all Georgia Southern in this first quarter. Furman's only score was a 95-yard kick return for a touchdown.
Look at the amount of plays. They've only gotten off 8 plays Furman has in this first quarter.
And the defense has not been able to stop Dominique Swope and company. It's Sean Boone on the stop, who was an all-freshman team member last year.
We know how good Swope is, but outside of that last drive where he didn't get any carries. Brown got into the game, hasn't touched the football yet. I'm not sure if he's a little nicked up from that big game week he had last week, but he's dressed out. He's on the sideline. He's been in the game. He has not touched the football. The reigning Southern Conference Offensive Player of the Week has not seen the ball this afternoon.
Isn't it nice when you can have the Player of the Week on the sidelines and a guy like Swope fill in for him?
You let your big guy rest up and your other guys get the job done just as well.
And why not? Jerick McKinnon able to pick up some positive yards across the 40. Ryan Steed among the tacklers. Preseason All-American, a second-teamer. When Brown didn't start at Elon, Jeff Munkin said, you know, they were very confident that Swope could do the job. Athletically, if you look at him, and physically, he looks like someone who's much older than he actually is, 18 years old.
But just a freshman. Said he has the body of a man. If you look at him, he's very, very well put together.
And he compared him to that man, number five, Robert Brown, when he was a freshman last year. Here's J.J. Wilcox. Furman has this played well. Nathan Wade slowed him down enough for Greg Worthy to eventually come up and make the play, preventing the first down.
It's a great job by Furman stretching out that pitch. Defenders not staying blocked, getting off their block, stretching the play out. And you know Wilcox has the ability to break a lot of tackles. They don't allow him to do it right there. String him out, bring him down for a loss.
Not just the first three and out for the Eagles that brought the first quarter to a close, but the first time they've been stopped at all in a first quarter dominated by the undefeated Georgia Southern Eagles. 5-0 and 4-0 in the league. And they have carved up the Paladins. That's Furman's only score, 95 yards for Cunningham. But they'll get it back to start the second.
It is rooted in tradition, yet always moving forward. It is challenging, with endless opportunities. It is large in scale, small in feel. It is bigger than a classroom and extends further than a campus. It is true blue. It is life-changing. We are Georgia Southern University.
Welcome back to Paulson, where Jeff Munkin's Eagles have a 10-point lead. Next week, we are going to head into North Carolina and get our first look at Jason Swepson, the first-year head coach of the Elon Phoenix, and his quarterback-receiver tandem of Thomas Wilson and Aaron Millett, taking on a Chattanooga team that impressed last week in a narrow loss here at Georgia Southern. And this week is expected to start Terrell Robinson at quarterback again, taking on Western Carolina.
Why not? The young man had a great game here against Georgia Southern last week. They just fine-tune a few things about him, but he almost got them a win last week.
Great hang time for Edwards. Will King will field it from the 10 and can't stretch it out. Great special teams play by Boyd Sasser. 49-yard punt. And a Furman team, Doug, that has one first down through a quarter, starts at its 11.
I'm curious to see the play calling on this drive. They're a little bit backed up inside their own 20 at the 11-yard line, 10.5, 11-yard line. But I'm really curious to see if they come out and try to mix it up a little bit offensively. Let Forcier air that football out. Try to get one of those defenders out of the box for Georgia Southern and test the secondary. You have a good quarterback. Let's put him to use.
Better than good. He set a Furman record for total yards last week in a loss. This is Cedric Cunningham on the receiving end of the first pass thrown by Forcier. It's good for a first down.
And there's that accuracy. You see him raise up. He knows where he wants to go. He wants to throw the slant. He looks to his right. He sees Cunningham. Cunningham shows him that 13, raises up, boom, throws a nice tight spiral and puts it on his receiver. Very, very good quarterback. They've got to cut him loose, though. The first couple of drives, I was unsure why they weren't throwing the football. We're down by 10 points now, so we've got to get something done.
Some of the things that Forcier has been able to accomplish this year, they're just impressive. He completed 20 straight at one point. That spanned three games. A
will try the option. This is Jarodis Williams. So Williams has a first down as A.J. McCray trips him up across the 35.
And we talk about Forcier and wanting to see him throw the football, but we have to talk about also, you know, Jarodis Williams, who's averaging almost 112 yards a game, one of the best backs in the Southern Conference. You have to give him his touches. You see they run a little variation of their speed option to the left. Good blocking downfield by the receivers, Cunningham and company, and Williams just picks a crease, gets north and south. This is a balanced drive, a little bit of run, a little bit of pass. That's what you want to see Furman do.
Back-to-back first downs. They had one prior to those two plays. That's Maples, the leading receiver, who went in motion. Forcier will go deep, however, and overshoot Daniel McFadden. And he had him, Doug.
He had him. A little bit too much air under that ball, but you throw those balls to receivers downfield, you want to see them run under the ball. Don't run to the ball with your arm stretched out because it actually slows you down. See Forcier rolls to his right. Good protection. You want to see a young man just run underneath that football. Run to the ball. Don't extend those arms. It'll slow you down a bit. Just a little too much air. Forcier wants that one back, but he had him wide open.
I wonder if that ball didn't carry a little bit. The wind is blowing pretty good at the back of this offense, and it looked as though McFadden thought he had a beat on it, and at the last second adjusted back. To the ground. Jarodis Williams gets a nice block from Ujas. Brings him for a first down. Westbrooks throws him out at midfield.
They've had success running these toss lefts and toss rights. Just a lead toss with the fullback leading around Uha, throwing some great, great blocks on the perimeter and springing Williams to the edge. And, you know, nothing fancy, just tossing it left, tossing it right, but they're mixing it up a little bit. This is the best drive they've been able to put together this afternoon versus Georgia Southern.
It's not even close. Easily the best drive. And, you know, it's only the third time they've touched it. Again, if you're just joining us, Cunningham, a career-long 95-yard kick return. The extra point was subsequently blocked. That's why it's a 10-point differential. Over the middle, Tyler Maples, the Tennessee transfer, works his way down close to the 40. It'll be an 8-yard reception.
I really like watching a really good quarterback like Forcier drop back and scan the field. You see, he looks back. His primary read is cover. He looks to his left. The back in the flats is actually covered by number 13 for Georgia Southern, Darius Eubanks. He sees him run out at the last minute and puts the ball directly on his receiver to pick up good yardage. You love to see a quarterback with that much master of the offense just scan the field and not lock in on the receiver and throw the ball where it's to the open man.
Really look like they're settling into a groove, or they were. That is big old Bailey who comes in and stops Caldwell behind the line.
Hey, you know, this is what this play is blown up. It's like a negative play for Furman. But this is what they have to do. They've got to mix it up. They can't come out and throw it every down. They can't come out and run it every down. But by doing that, they're showing Georgia Southern that they are going to still try to run the football. You have to respect the run, which sets up play action. You have a guy that can throw the football as good as Forcier. That's how play action passes happen.
This offense was looking more comfortable, now battling more than the defense, but the crowd as well. It is Tyler Maples who brings it in for a first down. Second reception of the drive for the leading receiver on the team, who averages 72 yards a game, sixth best in the conference.
Another transfer in Tennessee, guy transferring from Tennessee, but look at the patience by Forcier. Hangs in there, feels the pressure in his face, takes the hit, still delivers a catchable ball to Maples, who picks up the first down. This drive, not only do I like the way they're moving the football, I like the poise that Forcier is showing, and he's showing you why he is the most efficient passer in the league.
Seventh play of the drive here. It's the freshman back, Hank McLeod. McLeod gets an opening to the outside. It's a race down the sideline. And he stepped out. Stanley saves the touchdown at the 8-yard line.
I tell you, honestly, I've never seen a college football game where simple tosses to the outside have been so effective. But Furman has done a great job. As you see, they rotate the backs. They've got McLeod in there. He just follows around the end, follows his lead blocker, gets up the field, and almost takes that ball in for a score.
Maybe this is their speed back. 5'8", 184-pounder out of Tampa. First time Furman is in the red zone today. On a play action, it is Uha who brings it in. Touchdown, Furman. 35th career score for UHA, the active leader in the Southern Conference.
Those are the type of drives that Coach Fowler talked about that he wants. I want balance on offense. I want to see us be able to run the football and pass it. That's exactly what they do on this drive. You see Forcier, little play action, rolls out to his right. UHA catches it about three times, finally reels it in, walks it in for a touchdown untouched. But that's the type of drive that Furman's going to have to string together all afternoon to win this football game.
And they do the little things on the back end of that one, finishing it off to get back within three. What a drive. The drive that started at their own 11-yard line. Took them less than 4 minutes to find the end zone. And Furman claws back to within three. Georgia Southern was able to contain Furman in the first quarter, but it's an offense that averages 34 points a game, and this is their best drive of the game.
It's their best drive of the game. They were finally able to string some plays together. They mixed it up. They go with a little bit of speed option. Forcier pitches the football out to Jarotis Williams. He does the rest, picks up a first down. And you see they just run. They love this toss play. They've been running it all afternoon. He tosses the ball out to their speed back, Hank McLeod, who gets it down to the 5 yard line, inside the 5 yard line. Little play action pass by Forcier. Finds UHA out in the flats, bobbles it a bit, brings it in for the touchdown. That's the type of balance they have in order to stay in this football game and give themselves a chance to win.
They gave Georgia Southern a little bit of the Eagles' own medicine, using a variety of different players on the drive. Forcier was active, Maples with a couple of receptions. All three backs got into it. Jarotis Williams, McLeod, and UHA, who eventually capped it off. And with the wind, the kick will put Georgia Southern on the 20-yard line as we check in with Rashawn Ali.
All right, thank you so much, guys. Here on the Furman side, and let me tell you, Chris Forcier is really just kind of rattling everybody. You know, he's like going down the lane saying, hey, let's keep it going, let's keep it going. I think these guys have finally settled in, and we're going to be tit for tat here.
Rashawn, that's big. For a team that comes into an environment like this at Paulson Stadium, unable to stop Georgia Southern early and down double digits, trying to settle in a little bit.
You have to. Not just that, Georgia Southern knows they're going to get everyone's best shot and be the number one ranked team in the nation.
J.J. Wilcox is pounded down by Josh Lynn, the junior from Fort Lynn. Defensive end chases down the play after a four-yard gain.
And Georgia Southern has to know teams are going to come in here and play them very, very tough. They're going to get everyone's best shot.
Second down and six. More from the traditional triple option look today for Georgia Southern than last week. Charles having trouble with that wristband. He's got to hurry. And it'll be a Georgia Southern timeout. First timeout for the Eagles with 10-12 left in the half. And we're going to step aside. A rivalry that dates back to the national championship game in 1985 continues from Paulson Stadium next.
Coming up on the Season 5 premiere of Georgia Traveler, we take a trip to the thrilling Lake Lanier Islands Resort where Michelle gets a chance to paint the ponies, spend an evening at the luxurious Windsor Hotel in Americus, cycle through history at the Chickamauga Battlefield, journey deep into Providence Canyon, and dine at Canoe, one of the best-kept secrets along the Chattahoochee River. All that and more on the Season 5 premiere of Georgia Traveler.
Sunday at 7 on GPB.
Courthouse by the campus of Georgia Southern here in Statesboro, Georgia. Not too far away from Savannah, actually. Maybe about a half-hour drive from Savannah, one of the historical cities here on the East Coast. The majority of those Georgia Southern yards in the first quarter, this is their first possession of the second quarter. On the heels of punting the last time they had it. First time they didn't score. Jonathan Bryant caught from behind by Greg Worthy, but it's enough for a first down
We talked about it. They had to call a timeout. I think they got a little too fancy on that last play before the break. And I think Coach Monk said, you know what? We're not going from the wristband. We're just going to call the play in the huddle. Let's do what we do best. We're going to run the option. Give it to the B-back if it's there. If not, pick it to the A-backs.
This is a Georgia Southern team that really can do a lot offensively. They'll take a lot of snaps in the shotgun. They're very efficient when they do decide to throw. And it's Zach Walker wide open behind the secondary and inside of the 15 before Wade catches up.
That's what happens when you're able to run the football. When you're known to run the football, you get everyone on defense staring into the backfield. You get everyone staring into the backfield and not taking care of their responsibility. And there on defensively, you have linebackers and safeties staring at the running backs of the backfield. And that's all it takes for Zach Walker to get behind the defenders, and he's running scot-free. Whenever they do throw the football in this offense, there's usually someone wide open.
Got it. Only the second catch of the career for the freshman Zach Walker. And on the option, it's Bryant who cuts it back inside. Touchdown, Jonathan Bryant.
And just like that, they put the ball in the end zone. Big plays. You see J-Bo Shaw, he puts it into his B-back stomach, pulls it out, and then he pitches it out to his playmakers, gives Bryant the ball in space. Great blocking by Jarrett McKinnon and those receivers and those other backs out there to spring the running back. Makes it look so easy.
20th drive of the year for Georgia Southern. Touchdown drive lasting less than 3 minutes. Adrian Mora boots through his 126th consecutive extra point. He has never missed. That ties an FCS record that has stood since 2003, Montana's Chris Snyder. More importantly now, it's the Eagles back up by 10. Extra point for Adrian Mora, assuming it goes through, and why would you assume anything else, would be a new FCS record. For an option team, you'd think it takes them a while to score. 80 yards in four plays, Doug.
Not this option team, especially when you have guys like J-Bo Shaw running the show, and he's able to pitch the football to A and B backs like Jonathan Bryant, and then they go to the air. And they make it look so easy because that run attack makes the defense stare into the backfield. You've got guys running wide open. You see right there Zach Walker, and then guess who finishes this off? Jonathan Bryant takes it for the touchdown.
Three different Eagles have scored on the ground. And Doug, when both teams have thrown, they've lived up to the billing. Top two pass efficiency clubs. They've combined for just one incompletion in seven attempts. This is McLeod from the 25, that kickoff right into the wind. He's got 11 on the return.
I'm not sure if that was a sky kick or if the wind caught it and turned it into a sky kick.
That's a good point. Cunningham did go 95 yards earlier in the game. See that? Maybe Furman, Doug, has found something in that last drive. Can they build on that and continue the success?
Yeah, they can build on what I saw in the last drive is Georgia Southern was on their heels the entire drive. Forsyth was in control, whether they wanted to run the football or pass it. If they can continue that, they're going to be able to put up some points against this Eagle defense.
Both teams score a lot of points. The bigger question as we work our way through this game is going to be confirming, figure out Georgia Southern's offense. Carlos Cave on the stop of Williams.
And here we go with that lead pitch again. They love that play. They lead that tailback around with the fullback has the block on the end. But they're very effective at it. They're picking up yardage with it.
These coaches aren't strangers to one another either. Bruce Fowler on the Furman side was on the Furman staffs when Jeff Monken was on the Georgia Southern staffs before they became the head coach. That was back in the early to mid-90s. And then even at Vanderbilt, he faced some of the option teams, notably Navy and Georgia Tech. That run will bring up about third down and a long three.
think this is down to where Forsey is at his best when third and short, third manageable. They've been able to have success running the football because now he can go play action. And we know that he can throw very, very accurate, precise passes. If he can get a linebacker to step down and fight on that play action, he gets a little bit of space, he'll put that ball in there.
For Forcier. He's got a hustle. He's got 3 seconds on the play clock. Just gets it off with two. It'll be the freshman McLeod. First down. Good tough run. With Hudson Presume credit on the stop.
A good job by Forcier recognizing blitz and audibling the line of scrimmage, changing that play almost around a play clock. But they change it to that good old toss play they've been running all afternoon and picking up a lot of yards with. Doesn't matter which running back is in there. That's Hank McLeod on that carry. They both, him and Williams, have been very, very efficient running those tosses off the end.
Safe to say that this offense is finding a groove as we work towards the middle of the second quarter. Forcier to the air. He's got Ryan Colbreth, the redshirt sophomore from Conyers, Georgia. Down close to the 30-yard line for 23 yards.
He was wide open. That was a great ball thrown by Forcier. You see the little run action. The linebackers are down. Whenever you can see linebackers that close to the screen on play action, that's trouble for your defense. That means they're too far down into the line of scrimmage. Forcier sees that, puts the ball right over their heads, finds Colbreth on the sideline, picks up big yardage.
We'll go way back on you here for Colbreth. Mid-50s, a relative of his, Joshua. World records in the 300 and 440 yard hurdles. That's how long ago it was. Yards.
Imagine Furman 400 yards.
One hurdle. McLeod down to the 25-yard line. He's got six.
Here's another one of those drives that they put together, that last scoring drive they had. Nice mixture of run and pass. And when they have gone to there, they've picked up big chunks of yardage. They've shown they can move the football in this Georgia Southern defense.
Coming up on the sixth play of this Furman drive, which started at the Paladins' 36-yard line. Uha with the hand down to the fullback. McLeod the deep back and Maples in motion. Good pocket for Forcier, and he leaves McLeod too much.
Actually, that was smart that he did leave McLeod. Georgia Southern was in man coverage on that play. And you could see that LaRon Scott had McLeod man-to-man on the wide route. Forcier saw that, knew that the only thing that could happen there was that ball getting picked off or his running back being tackled for a loss. Very smart play, just throwing that football out of bounds.
Third down and four. First option's covered. And Forcier gets to the outside. Well defended.
Very well defended. Coach Fowler wanted a little pass interference, but we see the mobility of Forcier. And he's able to extend plays with his legs and the dual threat quarterback and get the job done running the football as well, but unable to pick up the first down on that play.
It'll be Ray Early to try this kick after Chaz Short has missed his last three over the last couple of weeks. So a former 3A kicker of the year in South Carolina, now a sophomore, has this one blocked. Second kick the Eagles have blocked today. The first was an extra point. And still on his feet and moving down was Lavelle Westbrooks. Thought his knee may have gone down early on in that play, but he's able to get up close to the 40-yard line.
And was Scott the one that got it and blocked it again? Was that him?
We'll see right now.
See, they get pressure off of it. It was. It was Scott comes through and actually blocks it. Let's see, Lavelle Westbrook corrals it. And the rugby scrum that ensued comes up with it and almost tried to take it back the opposite way.
Scott was the one who picked up the loose ball on the blocked extra point earlier and brought it all the way back for a couple extra points for Georgia Southern. A long pitch, well executed. Wilcox leaps his way for a first down. Kadarin Anderson on the stop.
Wilcox is a, I like to call a very, he's a very violent runner, like an Adrian Peterson type. When he gets the ball, he's going to hit you as hard as you hit him. You see him get the long toss. Good block by McKinnon out there. And he just gets the ball, reckless abandon with his body, will jump, do whatever it takes to pick up the first down. Good size back. You really have to wrap up when you try to tackle him.
Furman team that has had very rare success in this stadium. Not a lot of teams have had a lot. McKinnon, good catch on that pitch behind him. And he'll get some positive yards. Nathan Wade, Kadarin Anderson on the stop. Furman's 3-3 in Paulson since 2000. And this is a stadium, Doug, where the Eagles lead the Southern Conference with an 838 winning percentage. It's the toughest stadium to win at in the entire league.
And Furman's, yet they found a way to do it. Well, that's why this is their rival.
Including the last two times here. Shaw with an open man down the middle. Jarek McKinnon up for step to the 12. Greg Worthy likely prevented a touchdown.
McKinnon does it all for this offense. He can run it. He can catch it, as you see there, and he can even throw it when he gets this cast off. But once again, the running attack of Georgia Southern lulls linebackers and secondary to sleep, and they do not stay disciplined. You see them staring into the backfield. Jarek McKinnon is able to get vertical, and another big chunk of yardage picked up through the air by Georgia Southern. That running attack enables the passing attack to be wide open whenever they want to expose it.
33 yards on the reception. Shaw is now 3-for-3 for 110 yards. We talked about the efficiency of Forcier at the top. 3-for-3, 110 yards, Doug. That's perfect.
Yeah, when, I mean, they don't throw it a lot. But when they do, they throw it and they pick up big chunks of yardage because that run action has set the play up for so long that it's always there.
Up the middle for Robert Brown. Kadarin Anderson and Greg Worthy combine on the stop. Anderson had 20 tackles last week. That was a career high against Samford.
I believe that's Brown's first carry of the afternoon.
It is. You wonder if there's some type of injury or if it's just someone else's day.
You've got a stable of running backs like Georgia Southern has. It's, you can interchange those parts very easily.
Second down and 6. Little counteraction to Wilcox, who spins off Anderson. He's dropped by Colton Tegg afterwards. Mitch McGrath helped out.
It's a good job gang tackling by Furman. You've got to get a guy like Wilcox on the ground. He's a very physical runner. But I like the way Furman's defense is really bowed up and is playing a little tough down here close to the goal line.
Keg, who was a teammate of Uha when they were at Riverside Military Academy. Uha has the only offensive touchdown for Furman today. Keg had that stop. Eagles can have a first down at the 1 without score. Shaw will keep and get pile driven into the ground by Colton Keg.
Once again, great job swarming defense, not just having one man on the scene. You want to have multiple guys on the scene. The scene is where the ball is. And you see he makes one defender miss, but not Colton Keg. Brings down Jabo Shaw. You love to see that if you're Coach Fowler and Furman. Here we go.
Well, it's a field goal. He's pretty good at that, too. 51 career field goals made. That's the most in Eagle history. And he hasn't missed since last year. And that stretch will continue. But a big stop for this Furman defense, Doug, which really hasn't found a way to slow the Eagles except for one punt. They bend but don't really break. Let's check in with Rashawn Ali for what's coming up at the half.
All right, thank you so much, guys. Yes, coming up at the halftime, Georgia Southern's 1986 National Championship team will be honored as they commemorate their 25th anniversary. This season also marks Georgia Southern's 30th year of football in the modern era, of course, led by the late legendary coach Irk Russell. Coach revived the program in 1982 after a 41-year hiatus with a roster full of walk-ons and a football he bought from Kmart. And in four short seasons, the Eagles won their national championship, back-to-back championship. So we're so very glad that Irk Russell came here and instilled this legendary atmosphere.
And what a story.
Yeah. Not just a legendary atmosphere, a legend.
Wow.
You almost say this is the house that Irk built.
Walk-ons and a ball from Kmart. Talk about building it from the ground up.
Now it's six national championships. Including one when they beat the Paladins. With just over 2 minutes left, Furman will get the ball back. And Cunningham will have another opportunity, this one from nine. Slips just across the 20. Cunningham's had a couple of good weeks here. Not only a touchdown today, he had 250-plus yard returns last week, including what was then a career-high 57 yards.
Hey, very explosive football player. Makes a lot of plays the wide receiver position, but a lot of times your skill guys, your running backs, your receivers, your corners, you put them out there on special teams, punt returners, kick returners, they can make plays there as well.
Furman has two timeouts and just over 2 minutes left. Always like to point it out late in the half. It will be Georgia Southern who will return the opening kick in the second half. They deferred after winning the coin toss. Orsier doesn't have the speed to get away from Stanley. He can pick up a couple of yards. That's the difference, though, Doug, between this week and last week. When Terrell Robinson had so much success, we heard about the dual-threat quarterback that Georgia Southern hadn't prepared for. And while Forcier is absolutely a dual-threat guy for Bruce Fowler, he's not quite as fast as Robinson.
You hit it right on the head, and you look at a play like that, Robinson would have been able to break contain on that. Forcier has the amount, has the athleticism to get outside, but not the speed that Robinson has. But at the same time, Forcier can pick you apart with his arm, and he knows that. He knows he doesn't have to beat you with his legs all the time, but he can do just enough to win a game with his legs.
By Russell. There was a story on Russell this week, Doug. He came on his recruiting trip 4 years ago now to a game against Furman and said he loved it so much because there were guys just hanging out in the trees, just loved the atmosphere.
Young man, you can see how much energy he has if you just watch him play from Comer, Georgia. Very, very active defensive lineman. Makes a lot of plays for Georgia Southern. Let's see if he can make one here on this third and long.
Preseason co-defensive player of the year. Forcier with good protection. Hits Colbert for a first down. And plenty more for Ryan Colbert down inside of the 35.
And that's what having a quarterback like Forcier who can put the ball on the receiver in stride can do. You see Forcier scans the field, puts it. You love to see a receiver catch it where his feet do not have to stop. He puts the ball directly on Ryan Colbert in stride, and Colbert does the rest, gets north and south up the field. I'm telling you, Forcier, to me, is the most impressive quarterback I've seen in FCS. Hands down.
That was a 44-yarder. Feels the pressure. Lobs one again for Colbert, and he lost it.
I think the sun may have got into his eye a little bit. He's pointing up when he fell down. But that had 6 points written all over it. Once again, Forcier drops back. Good protection by that offensive line. But then he does a good job making a man miss, makes Tinsley miss. And then you see Colbert just loses the ball. You see he stops his feet. Forcier gave him a perfect football. But the sun definitely got in his eyes on that one.
You can see even the shadow of the ball across in front of him. Good news for the Paladins. They haven't called one of their last two timeouts yet.
Forcier over the middle. Tyler Maples brings in his third reception down to the 20.
Tyler Maples has been quiet. He's the team's leading receiver. He's going to be quiet this afternoon, but we know he can make big plays. A quarterback like Forcier is starting to heat up. So he's starting to throw that ball around. They've got to put some points on this board before going in for halftime.
Not only is Maples sixth in the conference in yards per game his last three games, he's averaging 94 yards a game the last three heading in. Forcier looking his way, bluffs to him, and instead goes to the end zone for Cunningham, who was blanketed by LaRon Scott.
Yeah, if I'm Furman and I'm Chris Forcier, I'm throwing away from number 34 side. LaRon Scott not only has been playing well on special teams, but he's one of the best defensive backs in FCS too, and especially in this conference. So I'm going to look away from him. Good job by Forcier trying to pump and get LaRon Scott to bite, but he's too good of a player. He's not going for that. Great coverage by him.
Second down and 10, and even 60 seconds left in the half. Furman tries to carry some momentum into the locker room. First target for the tight end, Anderson. What a grab from Colin Anderson.
Show some good hands for the young man that walked on this team. Eventually, I mean, originally was a quarterback that they've moved to tight end. That's a beautiful job with the extension, laying out, knowing where your feet are on the field, getting your feet down. You don't have to get 1 foot down in college. Gets both down. That catch would have been good in the NFL as well. Not only does he move the chains, he stops the clock for his team, and they don't have to burn a timeout. And they've got plenty of time to try to put this ball into the end zone.
But they do call a timeout now as Fowler runs down to call it, Doug, and that's a big mistake for Furman not having to use one. Second time they're in the red zone today.
I think they just want to make sure they get the right play called. But you hate to burn a timeout right there when you've got the clock on your side. And what I mean by that is you've got it stopped from a play you ran. You hate to have that.
Furman can be called one of the surprise teams in the league up to this point. Yet their schedule gets a little bit tougher now in terms of their conference slate. They've beaten the Citadel. They've taken out Western Carolina and lost last week to Samford, but now they've got Georgia Southern. Next week is homecoming against Wofford for Furman. And they've still got Appalachian State also, so can they sustain the momentum from the early part of the year?
Yeah, these schedules do not get easier as the season goes on for either one of these teams.
The senior who transferred in from UCLA, the San Diego native, Chris Forcier. Uha the fullback, Jarotis Williams the deep back. And this time I believe it's Georgia Southern. And Jeff Monken is irate. They didn't call a timeout. I wonder if Monken was arguing they didn't have time to get the right players onto the field. It's Jarotis Williams on the sweep. A first down to the five. Westbrooks drags him down by the shoulder pads.
And there's that toss sweep again. Actually, Jarotis says, I'm not even going to wait on my fullback to get around. He runs past his fullback, past his lead blocker. You see, he takes his little jab step, runs by Uha. Says, I'm trying to get into the end zone. Comes up a bit short, but once again gets out of bounds. Is not able to get out of bounds. The clock is still running.
It stopped briefly for the first down. It is first and goal. First option covered. Into double coverage now, and he's picked off. Hudson Presume.
Another one of those very, very good corners for Georgia Southern. They've got so many athletes back there in the back end that you have to be very precise when throwing that football. They bring some pressure up the middle. Pressure maybe makes him throw a football that he doesn't want to let go of. Presume is right there on the scene to pick it off to stop this drive.
A guy not prone to making mistakes throws just his fourth interception of the year. And it was the 10th pick for the Eagles, which is top 10 in the country. And instead of 26-20 at the half, Doug, now who knows? Great play by Ryan Steed. Furman's got a pretty good corner, too.
He's got a very good corner, very good size, just under 6 feet, 190 pounds. Ryan Steed has gotten a lot of attention from NFL scouts. Very, very good football player.
Steed, a senior out of Mount Pleasant, South Carolina. He's just over the Ravenel Bridge from downtown Charleston. The Eagles do have two timeouts to play with, and we've seen them strike quickly. They don't seem to be ones to sit on it, but it's exactly what Shaw does to the loose ball.
They're going to let this clock just run out those last two plays. They weren't very pleased with those. You see Jay Bowie gets the snap, feeds it into, and he's reading. And a lot of times when he's giving it to that up back, he wants to pull it out. The up back thinks he's going to keep it. They're kind of tugging at that ball. That's when you get a fumble and ball ends up on the ground. You see Coach Munkin talking to him about that mesh point.
Very schooled in the option under Paul Johnson. In fact, both of them are. Jabo Shaw started his career at Georgia Tech. They'll talk about it a little bit, even though the fumble didn't hurt him. Georgia Southern's defense with a big red zone stop, which swings the tide a little bit. It totally changes the complexion. Instead of Furman feeling good about their offense in the last couple of drives, they get picked in the end zone and head into the locker room down by 13 as we check in now with Rashan Ali.
Yes, thanks, guys. Here with Coach Munkin. What were you saying to Jabo right there?
Well, we had a play called, and he missed the read, and just trying to get it right. It was every opportunity to coach, so we're going to coach him up at those moments where we can.
Defensively, it seems like, you know, Furman has been getting a couple of long drives. Talk about that pick, though, and how it changed momentum of the game going into the half.
We were fortunate that they didn't throw a better ball. The kid probably would have caught it for a touchdown. I'm glad we got that, and they got some drives on us. That long 90-yard drive is disappointing to see. And we got to play better. We got to do a better job of covering the receivers and stopping from running the ball on the first down.
All right, good luck in the second half, Coach.
The pick leaves Georgia Southern up by 13. But Forcier and Co. did get things going in the second quarter. That's the 35th career score for UHA. 13-point game at the break. It's the SoCon Sports Network Game of the Week from top-ranked Georgia Southern, which leads Furman by 13 at the half. A lot of big plays featured in the first half. And right now, it's the Southern Pride Marching Band from Georgia Southern.
Margaritaville.
Southern Pride's marching band of Georgia Southern. Plenty more coming up at the half with the Eagles trying to hold on to their top ranking and undefeated season. Be sure to take a look at the band playing Bill Gap Buttercup as we carry on. The Southern Pride marching band still entertaining at the half. As we go down to field level and check in once again with Rashawn Ali.
All right, thank you so much, Darren. Here with my good friend Stephanie Singleton. And it's all about the features for the games of the week. And my favorite question every week, what's on tap?
Well, we're in Statesboro, Georgia for the second straight week.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll be joined by President Dr. Brooks Keel. And after having spent time in Florida State and LSU, Dr. Keel began his tenure as the 12th president of Georgia Southern on January 4th, 2010. In less than 2 years, he has already led this university to some significant milestones and is eager to continue to lead this nation. Dr. Keel, how are you today?
How could I not do any better? This is great. It's a great day for football, and it's a great afternoon.
So we're here, number one team in the country. What does that feel like?
Well, it feels great to be the number one team. It says a lot about what our coaches have done with these guys, and just put a big target on our back, there's no doubt about that. But we're really excited about what that means for Georgia Southern.
So you talk a lot about the Eagle Nation and what it means to be a part of this great tradition. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, Eagle Nation is 65,000 alumni strong. We've got 20,000 students on campus now, 2,100 faculty and staff. We have now broken that ceiling of 20,000 students, and I think that means a great deal to us. It says a lot about where we've come. It says a lot about where we're going.
So you've had some great milestones since you've been at Georgia Southern. One is the amazing enrollment that you had that you just spoke about. Another is the engineering program. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. Again, at 20,000 students, there's something magic about that number. It says a lot about where we are and where we're going, as I said. We just got approval to offer Bachelor of Science degrees in mechanical, civil, and electrical engineering. And I think that's, again, it says a lot about the academic components we have on campus. We train a different type of engineer here, a work-ready practical engineer. And when they graduate, they're really sought after by a lot of the industries and companies in this area.
What about the U.S. World and News Report? It said that this was one of the top five places to come to school. What is that like?
Yeah, it's really obviously a real honor for us. We're ranked the number four in the country in terms of the most popular universities in the country, behind Harvard, Stanford, and BYU. That's pretty good company, I think, to be in. And I think what it says is that we try really hard to make this university feel like a small university, but yet offer all the things that a major university can have. Makes our students feel comfortable here.
So what's next for Georgia Southern? I mean, they've hit all of these milestones. Where do you go from here?
Well, we're going to be pushing a research agenda on our campus. We're going to involve the undergraduate students in a research agenda that's going to make them more competitive in the marketplace. We're going to be looking at other type of graduate programs that make sense for us in this region. And we're going to put another flag on that pole down there for another national championship.
Last question. I saw a picture of you in Eagle Creek. Can you explain a little bit about that tradition for this football team?
Absolutely. I mean, Earl Russell started that in the 80s. It's not really a creek. It's a big drainage ditch. But he said there were magical powers in that water. And I told the players that if it made them better players, it'd make me a better president. So I got down in the middle of Eagle Creek wearing a suit, filled up a water jug of Eagle Creek water, and took it back to my office. So hopefully it's going to rub off on me, too, just like it is on these players.
That sounds great. Thank you so much for visiting with us, Dr. Keel. Really appreciate it. Darren, back to you guys.
Thanks, Stephanie and Dr. Keel. More coming up from Paulson Stadium, where Georgia Southern leads Furman 26-13 on the SoCon Sports Network. Good times at Georgia Southern. The enrollment is up more than they've ever had, and their football team is up number one for the fifth consecutive week and looking very impressive offensively. As we welcome you back into Paulson Stadium, along with Doug Chapman, I am Darren Goldwater. Doug, we take a look at some of the first half highlights. First and foremost, the first quarter dominated by Georgia Southern.
Absolutely dominated by Georgia Southern on the ground like they always do. You see the pitch to Wilcox, he walks it in. But then right back comes Cedric Cunningham with a 96-yard kickoff return to swing that momentum. They needed that because their backs were against the wall with the way Georgia Southern was able to move the football. Then on the extra point, you see They get it blocked. LaRon Scott takes it back the opposite way for 2 points. They just like that, Georgia Southern's got the lead. Jay Boshaw keeps it on himself over the left end, takes it in for a 2 yard score, but back comes Furman. Forcier finds Uha in the flats. Nice 8 yard touchdown pass. And then once again, another blocked field goal attempt. This time Georgia Southern was not able to get any points out of it, but they get the ball back. Jay Boshaw does what he does best. Pitches the ball to Jonathan Bryant, takes it in for a 14-yard score. And Forcier, they have a chance to score down here at the end zone. Ball's picked off by Presume right before the half, so Georgia Southern is able to hold that drive that Furman was putting together without giving up any points.
The half is more even statistically than I think it may have felt like because of the way Furman was able to really bounce back offensively in the second half.
And I think that Furman able to get 4 out of 7 third downs, that definitely helped them extend drives, and they were able to keep drives alive. And if they didn't get that interception there before halftime, it's going to be a different football game.
It would be a different complexion, that's for sure. They would be really right in the game with Georgia Southern getting it back here to begin the second half. When we come back, more from Paulson Stadium. It's a beautiful day here in Statesboro, Georgia for a football game. Back at Paulson Stadium with Doug Chapman up in the booth. I'm Darren Goldwater as we go back down to Rashan Ali.
All right, thank you so much, Darren. Here with Coach Fowler. Seems like you got your offense going in the second quarter, but how do you sustain those drives?
Yeah, we're not finishing them very well, and obviously we haven't kicked the ball very well and have left some points out there, actually gave them two when they blocked the extra point. But, you know, moving the ball hadn't been as much of a problem for us as of getting them stopped right now.
Now, GSU has given you a lot of looks offensively. How do you stop the run? I know that's a grand task in this type of offense.
Well, you know, they're executing better than we are, and you got to get off some blocks there and make tackles on the perimeter. And they've gotten the ball on the perimeter, and we need to try to get as many people the ball, pursue better, and, you know, hopefully we've gotten some things straightened out in for the second half, and we'll do a better job.
All right. Good luck in the second half, Coach.
Thank you very much.
Darren, Doug.
Bruce Fowler knows what it takes to be successful at Furman. He was part of the 78 and 80 Southern Conference title teams when he was a player at Furman. More from around the Southern Conference from a current standpoint. We take a look at some of the news and notes around the league. Georgia Southern maintains the top spot for the fifth consecutive week. Brown, who tied a career high last week, has been almost a non-factor today. And against non-conference schools, the league has done very well, doing well again today. Virginia Wise had a tough task going to Wofford, and that got out of hand quickly today.
Very quickly. We talked about being able to only have the Southern Conference Offensive Player of the Week and Robert Brown have, I believe, one carry in this football game, and you're still leading the game. Because that goes to show how good the rest of your running backs actually are.
Georgia Southern, after this game, has a home date with Presbyterian. And then the only home game after that is against the Citadel. They've got to go to App State. They've got to go to Wofford. And how about this, Doug? Just let's look all the way to the end of the year right now. And let's say, as we look at Georgia Southern's schedule coming up, let's say, look at the bottom. Maybe Alabama beats LSU. I wonder the last time, or if it's ever happened, number one FCS against number one FBS, because that could happen on November 19th.
That could very well happen, because Alabama does have LSU before that game. So if they beat them, they would be the consensus number one, and if Georgia Southern can continue to run the table, they'll be the number one, and it'd be something to watch. You know, because I can't remember the last time I can't say I've ever seen an FCS number one play an FBS number one.
Jeff Munkin keeps it game by game. I think he'd come up here and turn our broadcast off.
Yes,
hearing
he
us
would.
Talking about the Alabama game.
Not like that.
All right, LaRon Scott. He broke a big one in week one for a touchdown. And he's one of the leaders in the country in kickoff return yards, but he's bounced down across the 30-yard line. And he stays down after the hit.
Took a big shot as he was cutting back. I can't tell if it was in his head or his chest region, but he's rattled pretty good down there.
Scott had a 99-yarder in week one, and he's already made some plays here today. This is his kickoff return against Samford, 99 yards.
And not only is he one of the best defensive backs in this conference, he's one of the most explosive and dangerous return men. Definitely, Georgia Southern is glad he's on their team.
And hopeful this isn't serious. He won a national championship at the junior college level at Butler Community College before coming here to Georgia Southern. Let's see if we can see what happened.
See, as he's cutting it back, I can't tell if it's something in that shoulder. You know, you hate to take a guess, but you can't tell when he looked like he grabbed his leg on the way down. Hopefully, it's just something like a cramp. He's jogging off the field pretty good now, but cutting back, you can't tell where he. What was bothering him? This is grabbing that right leg. I think he'll be back in this football game.
A little bit of a sigh of relief on the Georgia Southern side to see him come off with ease like he just did. There's Jaybo Shaw. All his yards were compiled on his first three pass attempts. The incompletion was his last pass attempt.
Saw those yards his brother threw for last week up in South Carolina. He's trying to catch up.
Jonathan Bryant had a first half touchdown, but he is tripped up by the strong safety Nathan Wade, who came crashing into the backfield. Bryant got a yard anyway, though.
Furman's got to bounce back from the way their first half ended with that interception on that last drive before they go in for halftime. They had some momentum. They were able to move the football. So now defensively, they got to come out and make a stop, get the football back, and get their offense back cranked up.
You know, Furman can come back. If they can win this football game, there are a lot of implications, not only in the Southern Conference, but for this Paladin team also. Jarek McKinnon bobbles it, and it'll go out of bounds. It was Wilkins who got a hand on it. He's playing a lot today in place of Wiley. Heard a hand last week.
You see Jaybo Shaw, he pulls it out, pitches it out to McKinnon. That cast, maybe he can't feel that ball like he usually does into his hands. But that's the thing about this option attack offense. There's so much ball handling. There's so much fakes and pulling the ball out of the B-back stomach and pitches. But a lot of fumbles can happen. They don't turn it over a lot. You see a lot of option teams do put the ball on the ground a lot more, but Georgia Southern does not turn the ball over a lot.
Just like their red zone, Georgia Southern ninth in the country in their third down conversions, too. Great pocket to Shaw, complete to Wilcox. He pays the price from Nathan Wade, but it's a first down up to the 48.
I told you, a guy with Wilcox's skill set, Coach Munkin said, would be a wide receiver, a starting wide receiver at other schools. But in this offense, they have him as a running back. But you see here his skills. You see him climb the ladder and snatch that ball out of there. That's all a hands catch. You don't see many running backs with hands like that. Takes a big shot, hangs on to it. He's a big guy. But he runs routes as well as any receiver I've seen. Very smooth route runner, and we know how tough he is carrying the football out of the backfield.
And he is a former receiver. He's averaging over 25 yards a reception this year. That tends to happen with an offense this style. Down towards the 45-yard line here for Jonathan Bryant. This game is turning into the story of the two juniors from Cairo High School, the two high school teammates, Bryant and Wilcox. They're both doing a lot of damage.
Yeah, they've been doing a lot of work, especially in the first half, and they've picked up right where they left off here in the third quarter.
Going back to that thought about if Furman can win this game, it not only shakes up the standings in the Southern Conference, immediately they become a contender. They also start becoming a serious contender for an FCS playoff spot if they can win this game. And it's a team under the direction now of first-year head coach Bruce Fowler because they want to get back to that level. Wilcox will power his way for a first down into Greg Worthy, who makes the stop.
And we talked about it earlier. You see Wilcox again. We've been talking about the young man all afternoon. Can do the job, whether it's throwing it to him or pitching it to him. Jaybo Shaw runs that option down the right side of that line, pitches it out to Wilcox, breaks a tackle, gets north and south, just runs hard, picks up positive yardage, moves the chain for a first down. But it's hard to be number one. And when I was at Marshall, we went 1-1, wire to wire, won the national championship, but we got everyone's best game every week, and it got tougher and tougher. And you're seeing that Georgia Southern is getting everyone's best shot, no matter where they're playing, whether they're here or on the road. People are coming in here because everyone wants to beat number one.
Well, down close to the 30-yard line. give the stop to Josh Lynn. Yet going back to your Marshall days, was your schedule set up like Georgia Southern's, the fact that they're getting the middle to the bottom tier of the league first, and then it gets harder and harder as it went along? Is that a good thing for Georgia Southern?
You know, honestly, I remember my freshman year, we won the national title. No game was easy. We came down here. My first start was here in Statesboro against Georgia Southern. They played us tough. We had to go to Appalachian State. They played us tough. Citadel, Furman, they came to us, but they were still, it seemed like the schedule never got it. There was never any breathing room.
Intended for Wilcox, nearly picked by Worthy. It'll bring up third down and 5. Yet I think every team in the country would trade places. Yeah, it's tough to be number one, but it's better to be number one.
Oh, yeah. Hey, like they say, if you're not the lead dog, the smell never changes, you know? So you want to be the number one team. And it's fun to be number one, but it's a lot of responsibility. And I'm sure Georgia Southern and Coach Monken talks to his guys every day. You got a big bullseye on your back. Everybody wants you guys. They want to beat you. And certain teams, they want to see you lose because it opens the door for them. So they know they're getting everyone's A game when that ball's kicked off.
1-for-3 on their third down conversions to this point. Jabo Shaw gets smothered. Ricky Lang leads the tacklers. Checking it is Brandon Boykin, 33, not 93.
Here we go. We've run that option. Pulls it out of the B-back. Nowhere to go. You see Kadarin Anderson, one of the first guys there on the spot. We haven't called his name a lot. Very active linebacker from Greenwood, South Carolina. Makes a lot of plays. We're able to make Georgia Southern attempt a field goal here.
Yeah, a long one. A 49-yard attempt for Adrian Mora. And it is right down the middle. His career long was over 50 yards. It was a 50-yarder in 2009. He comes a yard away from that. More importantly, he's made it a 16-point Eagle lead. That is the campus of Georgia Southern University. Here in Statesboro with Doug Chapman, I'm Darren Goldwater. Let's take a look around the league to other scores today. Appalachian State was up big on the Citadel. Be interested to see how that game turned out, 49-42.
I thought that was going to be a runaway. Citadel fought back and lost that game by 7 points. Whoa.
And Elon and Samford will keep an eye on that. We will see Elon for the first time next week up at Elon. Leader in field goals. His next extra point will be a national record, 127 in a row. Cunningham from the goal line gets 23 yards.
Let's see what 4CA and company can put together. They had a nice drive going, didn't end the way they wanted it to early at the end of the second quarter, but they know they can move this football. They just have to play mistake-free, try to get themselves back into this football game.
Chris 4CA, who has spread it around this year. The interception, only his fourth interception thrown this season. It came at the very end of the half. He'll target Jarodas Williams out of the backfield. Great cut for Williams to get a couple extra yards up to the 40.
Jarodas Williams is a very, very gifted runner. He runs very, very well in space, has good balance, good lower body strength, and he can also catch the ball well out of the backfield. You love to see your running backs that you don't have to take off the field in passing situations. He finds Williams in the flats, and Williams turns back into a running back, just running through tackles and making guys miss. You got to have a back like this on your team that your quarterback can dump the ball off too short. You can pick up big yardage after that.
As a running back, Williams on pace for over 1,000 yards. It's been a while since Furman has had a 1,000-yard back. He can run with some power, as you see right there. Deion Stanley took a bit of a hit as he took him down. 1,000 yards hasn't happened since Henley Brigham in 03 for Furman.
It's a long drought of 1,000-yard rushers. And you said it, he's on pace. He's averaging 6 yards a carry today. So he's running a lot, but when they've run it, he's been effective.
14th in the country, 112 a game. And it does appear as though the second quarter trend is continuing here for Furman. Williams is strung down as I say that. Roderick Tinsley, the defensive lineman, wrapped the legs to slow him up. The trend I'm talking about, the ability to move the football for the Paladins, although now they're backed up to a 39.
And you know, it looks like that they have been able to move the football, but the thing is I'd like to see them more is be a little more creative with the play calling. I understand you want to be balanced, but you're down by 16 points. You got to be a little more creative, try to get some explosive plays. Williams is a good back. You don't want to feed him the ball when you're down by 16. We know Forsyth can throw it, so let's try to air this ball out, but not just when you have to, like now on 39 when it's expected.
And the Eagle defense can tee off here, too. First, a timeout is called by the Paladins. Pretty close to their numbers here on third downs. They'll have an opportunity when we come back. Forsyth and Bruce Fowler, the Paladins, looking at third and nine, trailing by 16 with under 9 minutes left in the third quarter. Wind blowing at a pretty good clip on an otherwise perfect and warm afternoon in Statesboro. And that wind is right into the face of this Furman offense. Looking at third down and nine. And as we were talking about before we went to break, an Eagle team with 16 sacks can come after Forsyth, and they do. Tinsley chasing him, gets away from Rowe, but Russell almost brought him down. Are they not going to flag? They did throw the flag. Okay. Intentional grab.
They're going to call grounding.
It'll be a sack for Russell, his 18th career sack.
Intentional grounding. Number five. The ball did not cross the line of scrimmage. It'll be a spot foul. Loss of down. Fourth down.
Unbelievably, Doug, first penalty for the Paladins.
We talked about it. These third and long situations allow a defense to just tee off on you. They show pressure pre-snap. Josh Rose on the left side of the line of scrimmage. He comes off the edge, and almost all of this pressure starts up the middle. And I want to say that that was Brent Russell who just got the back of his shoe to bring him down. And another short punt by Furman is going to give Georgia Southern great field position.
Continuing the trend this year for Chaz Short. And it'll be great field position for Georgia Southern, as Doug mentioned. Next week, we've got the Mocs of Chattanooga once again and the Elon Phoenix. That'll be up in Elon, a little bit north of Greensboro. Conference game big for both teams. They're fighting for a postseason FCS playoff bid. Join us next Saturday, 3 o'clock Eastern, 2 o'clock Central Time right here on the SoCon Sports Network. You'll get to watch Aaron Millett, just a tremendous receiver who makes big play after big play. Looking forward to seeing him. Shaw will pitch it out to Jonathan Bryant. Already a big day for Bryant. It's another first down for him. Up close to 70 yards on eight carries now for the night.
And Jabo Shaw just runs that option to perfection. He holds that ball to the last minute, keeps you as a defensive end guessing. You see him just option off. Mitch McGrath, number 20 for Furman, and he doesn't know where the ball's going. And by the time he commits, Jabo is able to pitch that ball to Bryant, picks up good yardage. And this machine, I like to call it, this big blue machine, is moving down the field once again.
Jeff Munkin, when we talked to him this week, didn't seem overly pleased with the one-point win over Chattanooga. Wide open, Sumner, the tight end, down to the 25. McGrath on the stop. He continues to stress, though, getting better week by week. And they've clearly gone the right direction this week.
You see Tyler Sumner over the middle. You said I'll get to in a second. You see Tyler Sumner over the middle, catches this. You like to see your big guys hang on to them, taking a big shot like this. The run game really opens that up. But you're exactly right, Darren. I mean, you hit it right on the head. But the thing is I think Coach Munkin and company, they're looking at this as a title team, the team that has a shot at going to the national championship game. And he knows in order to get there, you have to get better as a football team every week.
So he's going to be very critical of his football team, whether they win or lose.
Bryant nearly gets in again. A touchdown saving stop from Gary Wilkins after a 22-yard run.
Just like that. They're back down sniffing at the goal line. And you see Jabo Shaw. They haven't really used the B-back a lot, giving him down the middle of that defense. They've been pitching the ball a lot this afternoon. And Jonathan Bryant's been on the receiving end of a lot of those pitches. He's been able to pick up a lot of yards, almost at 100 yards without even getting it to 10 carries yet, averaging almost 10 yards per carry. And you see, they're just explosive on offense.
We got the Wildcat here with Jerick McKinnon, who lunges for the goal line, but he will be short. And the other thing I think a lot of people overlook about scheming for a football game and coaches, how much tape and preparation goes into it, and not just this year. Jeff Monken talked a lot about Bruce Fowler and when he faced him years ago when they were both assistants on these teams and when the option teams of Navy and Georgia Tech faced Bruce Fowler at Vanderbilt. He knows what Bruce Fowler was going to do defensively.
He knows these coaches have tendencies, and you get to know a person's tendencies, and it's like a chess match that goes on out there on that football field.
That's the second touchdown of the day for Jabo Shaw.
This game has gotten out of hand. You look at it now, it's 35-13, and it's that way. You see Jabo Shaw, he took one in off the left side of the line for short. He tries the right side of the line, has the same amount of success, ends up being 6 points.
And now we've been following it for 2 weeks. He's never missed an extra point. And this one will put Adrian Mora alone in the FCS record books. It might be a simple thing, but perfection in 127 tries is no simple task.
Yeah, as a player, I like to give kickers a hard time, but that's not an easy job. Trust me.
The graduate student from Dalton, Georgia, actually born in Mexico, puts the Eagles up 36-13. Hugs all around. That from the other kicker, Charlie Edwards, who's a pretty good one himself. For Adrian Mora. 127 of 127 in extra point attempts in his career. You got to imagine that he's been given a hard time for being a kicker as well.
Yeah.
Giving him some credit right now.
Yeah, you have to. We tease those guys. We used to always tease them, but I tell you, we weren't teasing them when we needed them to put one through to win a football game for us. And we know how important their job is. We trivialize it sometimes, but their job is just as important as anyone else on that football field.
And just look at today's game. The kicking game has been a big part of it. Georgia Southern has blocked an extra point. They took it back for 2 points. They've blocked a field goal. The punting game hasn't been great for Chaz Short. He's got two short ones. And it is a strength of Georgia Southern.
And he booms one. And the two short punts have led to short field for Georgia Southern to work with. You talked about it. You know, special teams is in kicking, the kicking game. You see how big it can be in turning football games around. And you cannot give a team like Georgia Southern that is that good. You can't give them anything. You have to make them earn everything going on the football field. As soon as you give them an inch, they will take a mile. Trust me.
Number one for the first time since 2001. They've held the spot now for 5 weeks. And Jarotis Williams gets stacked up by Darius Eubanks and Mention and a lot of other blue jerseys. No yards.
I understand that Furman's got to try to maintain some balance by showing that they can still run the football. They may run it, but they've got to find a way to get this ball downfield. They cannot have another stalled drive like they did previously.
For CA to Colbert. He's had a pretty big day today. To the 25-yard line. 5 yards for him. His third catch, he had the one big catch.
Love that speed of that Georgia Southern defense. Colbert brings it in, and as soon as he does, he's swarmed by blue jerseys. Westbrook gets him to the ground, but this defense pursues as well as any defense I've seen at this level. Very hard to go sideline to sideline on this defense, but they will be there.
Third down try for this Furman offense on the slant. Cunningham brings it in front of Presume for a first down.
And this coverage of Georgia Southern, these corners are not really pressing, so they're giving the receiver a free release off of the line of scrimmage where they're able to get inside position and get this slant. And Forsay throws a very good ball. He puts it on his receivers. But they've got to figure out a way to move this football down the field.
And quickly at this point, too, late in the third quarter, defense really hasn't shown the ability to stop Georgia Southern. Forsay, with everything covered downfield, will take a shot for McFadden, and it is out of bounds, throwing into the wind for the cousin of the Oakland Raiders running back, Darren McFadden. It's on a day when Georgia Southern honored a championship team from 1986, including Tracy Ham, who will be inducted into the Georgia Sports Hall of Fame and is scheduled to join our broadcast as well. Georgia Southern making another claim as the top team in the land. Forsier really took a big-time hit as Cave strings out Jarotis Williams.
I really like the aggressive play of Westbrook. You see him, he takes on. LaVell Westbrook takes on the lead blocker here, fights through him, and still ends up jumping in and assisting on this tackle here. That guy's not staying blocked. That's what you call that. That's a guy that wants to make a play and not staying blocked. You love to see defenders do that, take on a blocker and still contribute to the tackle.
Third down and 8 because of it. Georgia Southern brings pressure, which is picked up. And Cunningham will be short of a first down, well played by Hudson Presume at the 45.
And once again there, they're going to give you those little things underneath when they know you need a big yardage. They're going to sit back and play off coverage and like a mini prevent. Hudson Presume comes up, makes the tackle. Cedric Cunningham, nice catch, nice throw, but not enough for the first down.
Cunningham top 15 in Furman history in receptions. He needs one more for 90, but it brings out Chaz Short. And this is another good one. Good hang time. And Robinson doesn't call the fair catch and then gets hit early by Cortez Johnson. Doug, was Johnson just simply fooled?
I think he just had a mental slip there. He just wasn't thinking. He knows he can't touch that guy. He knows the rule. I think he just had a mental lapse on that play.
Also, he was waiting for the fair catch. It didn't come. And
kick catch and interference on number 4 on the kicking team. He did not give him an unimpeded opportunity to catch the ball. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
And you can see, he looks like he's going to hold off for a second, and he just, like he just breaks down and tries to go through Robinson. And unfortunately, young man, you cannot touch that receiver before that ball is in his hand.
And obviously, Ted Pitts meant number 18 there, Cortez Johnson, who's needing to give an explanation on Bruce Fowler's sideline.
But those are those times you try to avoid the coach. When you make plays like those, you don't want to run right to the coach because there's not really much you can say right there that's going to satisfy him.
And an otherwise tough day already. Jerick McKinnon speeds his way close to the 40-yard line. Worthy and Kadarin Anderson team up on the stop. 7 yards on the carry.
See McKinnon with that big cast in that right hand. Said he doesn't really feel anything when he gets hit on it. He's still been an effective ball carrier with the cast. Just carries it in his left hand and does what he does best.
Sophomore, who was a former All-State quarterback out of Sprayberry High School in Marietta, Georgia. And he's technically a quarterback on this team, but right now more of a slot back. Robert Brown bounces off of Wilkins to get the extra yards needed for a first down. One guy who got a lot of yards in the Georgia Southern Hall of Fame, Tracy Ham. He joins Rashawn Ali right now.
Thank you so much, Darren. Yeah, all those yards, 3,000 yards rushing, 5,000 yards passing, the most for any college football player, joined by the legendary Tracy Ham. How are you today?
We're very good. Anytime we're beating Furman on a good sunny afternoon, Saturday, sunny afternoon, we're doing fabulous.
Well, you know, today commemorates the 25th anniversary of the 1986 National Championship team. Take me back to 1985 when you did beat Furman.
Well, I tell you, it doesn't seem like the time has gotten away from us, but playing Furman, coming from Georgia Southern, you know, many people didn't know about us, but to be able to get on that stage and perform like we did as a group really made not only the university, but us as players proud.
Well, you know what? Irk Russell has done so much for Georgia Southern football, but you were there when he led this team and did so much for this particular college. Take me back to what Irk Russell was like.
Well, yes, I was there, and my neck was one of the necks he had his foot on when we was coming up. But Coach Russell was just fantastic. He was the perfect coach for this situation, for us as players, for this community. And we were just thrilled to have him as a coach and as a mentor and as a friend.
How did his leadership mold you as a man?
Well, I tell you what, he made you accountable. You know, his slogan was do right. You know, we try to figure out everything we could to do wrong, and he just say do right. So he made it so simple, but what he really did was made us accountable for who we were.
And this Georgia Southern team seems to be doing everything right today. Your prediction on the outcome of the game?
Well, we're playing well. I tell you what, Coach Munkin has done a fabulous job. As we was talking on the sideline, he really has the respect of the players and the community, the school, and in the coaching community, he's well respected.
Well, thank you so much, Tracy. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Darren and Doug.
Rashawn, thank you. Tracy was part of the ceremony at the half honoring that 86 team. And his number retired, that number 8 that you saw flying away from everybody. No one else has ever worn number 8 here at Georgia Southern. One number shy of it, Robinson, down to the 25-yard line. The stats are unbelievable. 8,969 total yards of offense, 5,700 plus passing. He'll be in the Georgia Sports Hall of Fame in the 2012 class. Guys like John Smoltz and Tom Glavin.
Some good company to go in there with, huh?
College Football Hall of Fame as well. If you've never been there, I would recommend it. It is in South Bend. Good place for it. It's going to be about a yard shy of a first down.
It's in the Canadian Football League Hall of Fame. So,
end of the third quarter. Ham and the team of 1986 on the field at the half. And as he put it, loving what they're seeing. Dominating Furman with one quarter left. ...15 minutes left to play in Statesboro, a place Furman has won in back-to-back trips. They've got some work to do here. Young and old enjoying a perfect Saturday afternoon for football. Georgia Southern only has two more home games left. The game against Presbyterian and the game against the Citadel.
Definitely can't complain weather-wise here on October the 16th, and it's well over 80 degrees.
Actually, every day, the expected high temperature kept going up.
I'm not complaining.
No. We'll be going into the mountains of North Carolina enough.
Oh, yeah. Get a little snow on you.
Third down and a little bit more than a yard for this Eagle offense, and they'll try Robert Brown. And I think forward progress will be enough. Ira McCune, back up strong side defensive end, number 99. Got the stop, and we'll see where they mark it.
Kuhn was in there. Also, Kadarin Anderson was in there. A young man who hadn't called his name a lot this afternoon. Great linebacker, one of the best in FCS. A lot of NFL scouts have been watching him, but Georgia Southern's done a great job of neutralizing him. He hasn't made a lot of plays. The offensive linemen have been able to get up to him. Play action has given him some issues this afternoon when they have thrown the football. Georgia Southern's doing a great job mixing it up offensively.
Anderson averages a league best 11 tackles per game.
He had 20 of them last week.
And I pointed out he's the active leader in the Southern Conference. Georgia Southern has dominated the fourth quarter. They've really dominated all quarters this year, just out of the reach here of a diving Walker. They've outscored their opposition 58-26 in the fourth.
Zach Walker is another one of these interchangeable pieces they put in that can make plays. Jabo Shaw puts that ball, it's a little bit too long for him to reach out and get, but they don't throw it a lot, but they will throw it, and they're effective when they do it.
Walker had a career-long 50-yard reception earlier in the game. Almost had his first score. Shaw gives it off to Darian Robinson, who cuts it downfield to the 15. Mitch McGrath, the junior from Longwood, Florida, with the stop.
This has just got to be frustrating defensively for Furman. If you're out there, you know, you're down, you haven't been able to get anything going offensively, and they're sniffing at your end zone again, and they're just methodically moving the football 2 or 3 yards here, 4 or 5 yards here. They're keeping drives alive. You see the rushing yards. They're 221-71. This is what Georgia Southern does to people. This is actually a modest day rushing for them.
Yeah, they average 375. And it feels, Doug, that they have more yards. It feels as though the stats should be a little bit more lopsided. This play read well by Kadarin Anderson. I think he got the face mask, too. A flag comes in.
I want to say he did.
It's a shame. He read the option perfectly.
15 if it is, yeah. There's no more 5-yarders in football.
Personal foul, face mask, on the defense, half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Another flag just got thrown. And you see it right here. He's got him on the side of the helmet. And every face mask now is 15 yards.
Dead foul, unsportsmanlike, number 46 on the defense, half the distance to the goal, first down.
That's tough out of a senior. Maybe some frustration there.
We talked about it. You know, 20 tackles last week. He's a Buck Buchanan watch list. Stud linebacker and hasn't made any plays today.
Well, it's quiet. Officially, he's got 11 stops, which is right on his average. I think it's so quiet because when he's making those stops, Doug, it's
6-7 yards downfield. Yeah. Not taking anything away from him. He's a very, very good football player. But he usually makes a lot of plays in opponents' backfields. Haven't seen a lot of that from him this afternoon.
So it's first and goal for the Eagles. And they'll try Robert Brown, who dances towards the right. He'll be stacked up. Ricky Lang led the tacklers.
Sure, you know, you talked about it. You know, we talked about the frustration if you're on the side of Furman. And like you said, it feels like they have so many more yards rushing. And it just feels like Georgia Southern's had the football the entire game. It's just a type of offense that they just eat the clock up and they eat the field up. And sometimes as a defense, you feel helpless, like there's nothing you can do, and you're out there forever, and they just keep moving the ball, getting first downs, eating the clock up. You get the ball back with no time left.
Nico Hickey has checked in as one of the slot backs. Brown was hit behind the line, but dives in for the score. Matt Solomon almost got to him, but Brown falls forward. You know, the first game we did, he hadn't lost a yard yet prior to last week's game.
See him here. They put him in. He didn't start this football game. It gets it at the B-back. Last week had 178 yards versus UTC. No touchdowns. Today gets in. Not a lot of carries, but got himself a touchdown.
Fourth of the year for Brown. They really spread the wealth out today. Shaw's got a couple rushing touchdowns. Wilcox, Bryant, and Brown each with a score. And Georgia Southern is rolling up Furman with 12 and a half minutes left in Statesboro. We highlighted at the top that the road team has won this game the last 4 years. That trend will likely stop today. It's not just the number one football team in the country here in Statesboro. They have a great tradition in baseball. And the latest to make it up to the professional ranks, Everett Tiefert joins Rashawn Ali.
Yes, Everett Tiefert, so very happy that you have joined us today. Pitcher for the Kansas City Royals, also a Georgia Southern alumni. How's it feel to be back today?
It's great. Football team's playing well. School's growing. It's always fun to get back.
Now, you got your first win on September 11, 2011, over Seattle. What was it like having been in the minors for 5 years, you know, trying to make your way up to the majors? What was it like when you got that first win?
It was amazing, especially on September 11th. My dad was actually flew out to Seattle to watch the game. So it was real special to get my first win, and hopefully it'll be one of many.
Awesome. So how did Georgia Southern prepare you for Major League Baseball?
The coaches were great. You learn, I mean, you're way ahead of the game once you even get to minor leagues. They helped me out a ton, and I'm always grateful for what they did.
Thank you so much for your time, Everett.
Thank you.
All right, Darren, back to you.
I saw Everett pitch. He didn't look dominating on the mound. He's not the biggest guy out there, but he is a flamethrower. 17-yard return for the Paladins. And anytime you got a lefty who can throw strikes and with good velocity, you've got a shot.
I wouldn't want to be in the batter's box when that's coming in.
You know, that baseball program, Georgia Southern, just won the Southern Conference Championship.
Yeah.
This past baseball season, they actually got their rings at halftime last week. Things are going well for Georgia Southern. We'll see if Charlton Young, who we talked with last week, Rashawn did down on the sidelines, the head basketball coach and former star here with the Eagles, if he can get that basketball program rolling.
Coach CY.
FCA has trouble with the snap, able to get a yard.
A little frustration on behalf of the Furman players, a little extracurricular pushing and shoving after the play. Cameron Mason, kind of. That's what happens though when you come in with expectation of beating a team and they beat you the way Georgia Southern's been able to do it today. It can be frustrating. You have to keep your composure though.
At times, Furman has been able to move the ball, particularly in the second quarter. They really had success offensively. And you know, maybe that we look back to that interception at the end of the first half. There have been a lot of big plays. That may have been the biggest. Looking for the tight end, Anderson. What a catch from Colin Anderson. He cannot break away from Stanley. He is down to the 12.
And they've been able to do some things like that. They've been able to use a little play action here and get the ball over the heads of this Georgia Southern defense and catch them asleep. You see Forcier drop back, little play action pass. Throws an absolutely beautiful football to the tight end, Colin Anderson. And, you know, we talked about Colin Anderson. He has great hands. You know, this kid came here as a quarterback, walked on the team, and as of late, he's, you know, been a very, very sure-handed receiver. You know, Furman's had opportunities. It's just that when they get down, it's time to put their foot on the gas, something stalls.
Anderson leads the team in receptions, coming off a career-high 9 for 110 yards last week. And now a fumble inside of the 10. Just what you were talking about, Doug. Cash in on the opportunities, although I think Furman did get this one back. They did.
Fortunately.
Yeah, it looks like Jordan Eshelman, registered senior from Michigan.
And you see here, they run that little toss that they've had success with all to the left with Hank McLeod. It's a shot, and just the ball squirts out. Lucky for them, Jordan Eshelman with Johnny on the spot, able to fall on that football. If not, that would have been right on cue, is what I've been talking about, has plagued Furman this afternoon. Not able to finish drives. They can make plays, they just can't finish.
Modest numbers there for Chris Forcier. What's coming from his blind side? He throws one out of the end zone. I'm not sure if he wasn't just throwing that one away.
Good coverage on that play by Georgia Southern. And just, I said, it seems like Furman doesn't have plays dialed up to score touchdowns. They can eat up big chunks of the field, but once they get in close, they just don't have touchdown plays.
And you mentioned good coverage. It seems like when Furman has made plays in the passing game, they've been great plays. You know, the easy play hasn't been that. I mean, they've been blanketed all day. Third down and goal. From the 7, they'll try Tesso Uha, and Javon mentioned strings him down at the 11.
Once again, that Georgia Southern defense bows up near their own end zone and makes a play when necessary. They try the pitch to the bigger back, Uha, put him at tailback. He's let in there by the fullback, Tony Caldwell, but they'll try a different combination, but the results didn't work out very well. Georgia Southern was there, sniffs it out. Fullback gets nothing out of it.
I think I said third and goal before. It was third and 10. They can get to the 2 for a first down. They'll try it on fourth down here. They've been excellent in this spot this year. Pressure on Forcier, and what a play by Deion Stanley. He prevents a touchdown.
Very impressed with Georgia Southern secondary. Their corners and safeties, they all play very well, and they make big plays. You know, that's a sign of a championship team. They make plays like this. You want your playmakers to make plays when needed. Fourth down, that ball was catchable. That would have been a touchdown.
Only the second time in 11 tries that Furman has not converted on fourth down, so Georgia Southern gets it back up by 30.
Next time on Ground War, the ultimate combat vehicle has 3 requirements. Mobility.
These chariots had to be able to turn on a dime.
Force.
It was meant to ride directly into the infantry to attack.
And protection.
For the first time, it incorporated sloping armor.
Never seen anything like this.
Battlefield mobility on Ground War.
Tuesday at 10 on GPB.
Not the day Chris Forcier envisioned when he came down to Statesboro hoping for an upset of the top team in the country. He talks with Craig Clark, the head trainer. Craig was, before Furman, actually an assistant on the training staff down at the Citadel.
Looks like Forcey maybe favoring one of his hands.
This is how dominant the Eagles have been. You can almost take one of those possessions away. They knelt on the ball at the end of the first half. So in a way, it's 8 possessions and 7 scores. And Izzy Yeute is the quarterback. Flags on the first snap for him this game. Yeute, the redshirt freshman out of Hardy County High School in Florida.
False start, 62 offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Doug, it's so important. And fortunately for Georgia Southern and Jeff Monken, they build big leads, or they have thus far this year. When you're running this type of offense, your quarterback gets hit, you need guys with experience, and UU is getting a lot of it this year.
And you saw that with Zach Lonis, another backup on the offensive line. You need, you hit it right on the head, these backups need to get experience, because you never know if a man goes down when a running offense that moves the ball on the ground this much. You have got to have depth in those positions.
Speaking of depth, that is Devin Scott's first carry in a couple of weeks, and only his 4th of the year. 5 yards for him.
Another one of those backs they just plug in there, and you see UU keeps it, pitches the ball out to Scott. Scott gets up, puts his foot in the ground, gets north and south. See if Mr. UU can have as much success running this offense as J-Bo Shaw did all game.
He's already had one tremendous game. He is a Southern Conference Freshman of the Week from earlier this year when he lit up Western Carolina for 119 yards on the ground. It helped that he had an 85-yard touchdown run.
Well, that always helps your average up. That never hurts the average.
It's pronounced Izzy Yeute.
You know what's scary about this Georgia Southern team? I mentioned he was a freshman of the week. Darian Robinson has been a freshman of the week. They're not especially old, you know, in terms of junior and senior. This is a timeout first. Jeff Munkin was right in the ear. Yeah, they got it. They got the timeout before the flag.
Georgia Southern, that's their first timeout of the half.
Munkin was right in the ear of the field judge, Michael Clary. So he got that timeout just in time. Doug, back to that point. On the offensive line, which is excellent, there are three seniors. Jaybo Shaw is a senior quarterback. The rest of the playmakers on offense, their juniors are below, and most of them are below.
And two of those key makers, you look at Jerick McKinney, he's a sophomore. Robert Brown's a sophomore. Now, these guys are very, very young. You hit it right on the head. They've got a lot of youth on this football team. J.J. Wilcox is a junior. They've got a lot of guys that will be back. Jonathan Bryant, junior.
Yeah. Look at the defensive side for Georgia Southern. Yeah. Three of their starting defensive linemen are coming back. Brent Russell, the oldest, is a redshirt junior. All three starting linebackers, a couple of juniors and a sophomore. They'll lose LaRon Scott next year and Hudson Presume. We might be watching just the start of something. They might be good now, but as Nico Hickey works his way close to the chains and should have enough for a first down.
Nico Hickey on the carry.
Look, you talked about getting these guys that don't see a lot of action. Some playing time. You see the UU. It's just like Jaybo Shaw there reading that defensive end, pitches that ball out, gets it to Nico Hickey. Nico Hickey's able to pick up. He's actually a senior on this team, and you like to see your guys get out there, even if it's a big lead. Coaches still want to see very crisp performances. They don't want to see a drop-off in the production. If there is, they don't care how bad they win the game. You will hear about it in film session.
And particularly Jeff Munkin, who has been stressing improvement week by week all year long. There's a couple more yards for the Eagles as we work our way down towards 7.5 minutes left with Georgia Southern on top by 30. Yeah, that's one of the most impressive things. This team is a reflection of Jeff Munkin. You know, he continues to talk about not caring about the ranking. And again, we talked about this. It sure feels like they have a lot more than just 279 yards on the ground.
And they feel like they've had the ball the entire football game.
7 minute disparity. They've had it for 29 minutes. They get there on Scott, and the ball comes free. Nathan Wade with the hit. And Georgia Southern's got it back. Nico Hickey recovers.
Said it, Nathan Wade with a big shot. You see UUD pitches that ball out to Hickey. I'm sorry, to Scott. Wade just unloads on him. Georgia Southern is lucky that Nico Hickey was able to get that football back.
And if you're just joining us and you see this score and you hear us talking about it, feels as though they've had it the whole game. There was a point when it was close. In the second quarter, Furman was moving the football. They had it down to 3 points. They were driving at the end of the half and threw a pick in the end zone with less than 30 seconds left. It was 26-13 at the time. You score there, it's a one-score game at the half.
You're right. Furman was in this football game. They were in it. They had opportunities to either take the lead or get within the lead within a few points of it, but they weren't able to capitalize, got down and got behind, and they got predictable. You know, when you're able to, as a defense, when you can get a team in third and long situations, you just tee off and come after the quarterback, and they were able to do that, and Furman could never capitalize.
Into the wind, Edwards has this one really hang up on him. And well, King's going to take it anyway. He may have called fair catch and then ran. That's what the flag is here.
I don't think he called fair catch. I think he was yelling Peter to his own teammates, and the ref thought he was calling fair catch. He was waving his own teammates off. His hand never went above his head.
You see King there trying to get in on the conversation.
Yeah.
We have to lay a game on number 81 on the receiving team. A getaway signal was given by the receiving team, which means number 81 cannot advance the ball after recovered. After the 5-yard penalty, first down.
They're saying someone else threw a fair catch signal up. Yeah, he's just pointing. Yeah, no one ever gave a fair catch call there. I think the refs missed that one there. Wow.
So they'll back him up to the 38, and that's where Furman's possession will begin, and they'll go to their number two. Fowler calls on Dakota Derrick, a junior from Conway High School. That's in the Myrtle Beach area. Played in four games this year. He's a bigger guy, 6'4", 210. He'll give it off to McLeod. First down reception for the freshman out of Tampa. Down to the 45-yard line of the Eagles. Another look at the McLeod reception.
See that big quarterback there, Dakota Derrick, 6'4". Nice little safe pass to get yourself warmed up. Dumps it off to Hank McLeod. Let's Hank McLeod do the rest. That's pretty much what you're going to see for the rest of this football game from Furman.
You see it a lot in the league with all the tradition. You see guys who have a lot of roots in the league. That ball right through the hands of Cunningham. And Dakota Derrick has long-standing roots in the league. His dad was a tight end at Wofford, which is a big rival of Furman. I mean, they're 20 minutes away. His grandfather played at South Carolina. I mean, he's been around the Southern Conference ever, or at least I'm sure being told about it.
Oh, yeah. See if Dakota Derrick can dial up some plays to help put his Furman Paladins on the scoreboard a little bit.
5-for-12 on the season passing. He slips away. A Jeep chasing him, but it'll eventually. Looks like it was Connell Reddick who eventually got him.
Takes a shotgun snap. Looks downfield, sees nothing. It's a good job by the backup quarterback. Pulls it down instead of forcing that football in there. Pull it down and try to pick up some positive yardage. He's nowhere near the scrambler for it. So you see him get up a little attitude there, get a little shoulder to the defender. But gets the job done, pulls it down and picks up positive yardage. I like to see guys still competing no matter what the score is. And love seeing that.
This game really got away from the Paladins in the third quarter. Touched on how it was close in the second and down towards the half. Third down and long to the air for Anderson. Another great grab and a touchdown for Colin Anderson. 44 yards.
You like to see guys still fighting. There's guys out there still fighting. They're down. You know, they're like, hey, these football players have pride. You know, they don't want to just go out with this type of beating. So even though the twos are getting in there, guys are still trying to make plays and make this score respectable.
Furman has a long history of good tight ends. Colin Anderson is adding his name to that list. Let's get another look. All of his catch, he had a diving catch and two beautiful grabs just like this one does.
He's got great hands. You watch him run the field. He starts right with Dakota Derrick. This is just a beautiful pass. It looks like a little bit 4CA-ish. Delivers a great ball to Colin Anderson and finds that big 6'4" tight end streaking through the middle of the field on a seam route. That is an excellent play. Actually, safety for Georgia Southern. Boyd Sasser tried to swipe that ball out of the air. Comes up a little short. Ends up resulting in 6 points for Mr. Anderson.
Anderson, who has a new career high for the second straight week, 111 yards. Let's go down to Rashan Ali.
All right, thank you so much, Guy. Now, this year, Georgia Southern is wearing a GB sticker on the back of their helmet to honor Gene Bishop, a member of the Georgia Southern Athletics Hall of Fame, who passed away earlier this year. Now, he served as the chairman of the Southern Boosters Association and was responsible for the funding of the Bishop Fieldhouse right here at Paulson Stadium. Now, he holds distinction as the single largest contributor to the Georgia Southern Athletics Department. He also donated to GSU's College of Business Administration and also alumni relations. So Gene Bishop did a lot for this university. Darren and Doug.
Hey, Rashawn, right over your right shoulder, is that Gene Bishop Fieldhouse.
You know you're pretty important to your school when they put your name on something. Done something right.
That's why they also have inducted him as an honorary member as well. Georgia Southern will win its eighth consecutive Southern Conference game. That's the longest overall streak in the league. It'll be their 12th win in their last 13 games going back to last year. Granted, there's still 4:19 left. Furman will likely try an onside kick. That's at least what Georgia Southern is expecting. For the grab by that young man, Colin Anderson. Early will kick. He'll kick it deep. Georgia Southern will start on the 20-yard line.
The Eagles were expecting an onside kick there. You know, honestly, if I'm Furman, why not? Why not kick an onside kick, try to get it back? But they've seen what this Georgia Southern offense can do, so let's not give them a short field in case we don't recover that onside kick.
And give your defense a little bit more time to work on the option. They have faced the Citadel. They had a lot of success early in the year.
Right.
Now Georgia Southern, next week, Wofford.
And it gets no easier going against that Wofford attack.
Yeah, how'd you like to play these two? You've talked about it a lot, how defensive linemen in particular don't like to play against option teams. You're taking a beating. You got to do it back-to-back weeks against two teams that do it as well as anyone in the country. Izzy Uyu, it's his second series. And the freshman works his way across the 25-yard line, tackled by Kadarin Anderson.
He's brought down by Kadarin Anderson.
And look at that young man, Yute. He's going to be the future of this Georgia Southern offense and heading that option attack. I'm sure he's in Jabo Shaw's back pocket every day in meetings and in practice, just trying to soak up and learn as much as he can about this offense. So.
And with a lot of the blowouts that Georgia Southern has had, he's seeing valuable time. Reads this play perfectly well and darts into the secondary. Ryan Steed takes him down just shy of midfield. 22 yards for Uyu.
Now we see it here. What Uyu may lack in experience that Jabo Shaw has, he definitely has the edge on him in athleticism, and he's a little faster than Jabo. And he just gets north and south, reads that hole, gets in there, and picks up big chunks of yardage. I'd love to see that out of your backup quarterback.
See number six in the game as a B-back, Zeke Rozier, a senior who turns 23 next month. He gets some playing time. He was the decoy here for Devin Scott. Scott's got a first down, dancing his way inside of the 40-yard line. Stopped by Austin Williams. Doug, they just keep coming at you.
Doesn't matter who they plug in. They plug in new guys, same results. You see UU keeps it, reads the defensive end, picks it to Scott. Scott gets in and makes a couple of nice moves, gets upfield, secures that football. I love seeing that out of running back. Both hands on the ball. Picks up positive yards, and just like that, this blue machine is moving the football just like they were in the first half with their starters out there.
Georgia Southern's next Southern Conference game is in 2 weeks. They've got Presbyterian first. And what a game that'll be, and we'll be there up in Boone. Georgia Southern and Appalachian, that'll again be in 2 weeks. There goes Uyute, darting towards the corner. Touchdown, Izzy Uyute, 37 yards.
Without getting ahead of ourselves, imagine that young man with a little more experience under his belt in a couple of years here in Statesboro. How this offense will be looking. You look at UU, he pivots out on the option. He has no plans on pitching. This misses him all day long. Uses that speed, gets in, and look at the athleticism towards the end of the play, getting that ball across the pylon, gets inside of the pylon, picks up six more points.
And he outran Ryan Steed, who tried to get the angle on him, a guy who some draft services believe is the best corner at the FCS level. So the Eagles get to 50. Uyute's third touchdown of the year. 2.5 minutes left. Second touchdown of Izzy Uyut's young career. That one from 37 yards, and it gets Georgia Southern to 50 points for the third time this year. They hung 62 on Tusculum, 52 on Western Carolina. And they've got 50 on a Furman Paladin team that started this year 2-0 in the Southern Conference. And now, Doug, the numbers starting to look more like they feel.
They're getting closer to their average. They're at 360. They need about 14.7 more yards. And they're right at their average.
Those six rushing touchdowns that you saw by five different players, furthering the point Doug and I have stressed for a while, that they just, if not plan A, plan B, and if not that, then plan C or D will work just fine. Here's Cedric Cunningham. He took that one off the hop at the 11 and gave him about 9 or 10 just across the 20. Next week, be sure to join us. The SoCon Game of the Week heads up to North Carolina. On the campus of Elon, Aaron Millett and company welcoming B.J. Coleman and the Mocs of Chattanooga. And will we see B.J. Coleman will be a good question. And Dante Taylor, for the running back for the Elon Phoenix. Elon Chattanooga next week, 3 o'clock Eastern, 2 o'clock Central. You know, for more on Elon, I'd recommend looking up some of Adam Smith's articles. He does a fantastic job covering the Elon Phoenix and wrote a great piece on Dante Taylor late this week. A running back that we'll talk more about next week as Maples can't bring in the throw from Derek.
He had two receivers in the same area there. Maples and Anderson. I'm not sure if that ball was actually intended for Maples. Looked like Derek was trying to hit Anderson on that same route that they hooked up and scored a touchdown on earlier.
The touchdown pass from Derek was his first passing touchdown. You know, Doug, he only had 13 yards passing on the year coming into this game, and he had a 44-yard touchdown strike. 6'4 junior from Conway hits Tyler Maples. Close to a first down. He needs the 31, and it'll depend on the stop or the spots. Stevenson on the stop. They gave it to him.
We talked about B.J. Coleman a second ago at Chattanooga. Tyler Maple was a teammate of B.J. Coleman's at University of Tennessee before they both transferred to their respective schools now. Maples was a phenomenal high school wide receiver in the state of Tennessee and put up huge numbers. Unfortunately, he hasn't been able to have a big day here against Georgia Southern.
Kind of bided his time a little bit at Furman. He was behind Adam Mims, who was a special player for Furman. Now he's kind of in the spotlight himself. Adam Juan Daniels knocks out Derek there. Stops the clock with a minute 39 left.
Right now, if you're Coach Fowler and Furman, you want to see your reserves go out there, not only fight, but put together a constructive drive, you know, like the last one they had. Let's get something out of it. Go home with not just all the talk won't be negative on the film session, won't be all negative. Ride back won't feel so negative. Let's end this thing on a strong note.
Second down and short. Derek able to step up and fire incomplete. Almost another great one for Anderson.
You see Dakota Derek pointing at himself saying that was his fault. Shouldn't have led him so much, but Colin Anderson almost still reels that football in. Made a few tough catches this afternoon, and I wouldn't have been surprised had he come up with that one.
Chris Fowler was defensive coordinator, assistant head coach at Vanderbilt. He was on that staff for the last 9 years before taking over the reins at his alma mater. He took over for Bobby Lamb here at Furman. Good friends. He talked about that this week. Good presence from Dakota Derek. He's able to slip some tackles and work his way up for a first down with a minute 26 left.
Not the most fleet of foot guy you want to see, but in the short time he's been in this afternoon, when he's pulled it down and scrambled, he's picked up first down. So he's he pulls it down, and only when he knows he can get the first down and when he absolutely has to, which is smart, what you want to see out of a quarterback, and he's a senior. I'm sorry, I take that back, a junior, an upperclassman. So he's been in the system for a while.
First down and 10, and this time he's got Maples. And Maples gets close to midfield, and he is gang tackled by Brandon Lane, 5'8 junior from Marietta. Deep onto the Georgia Southern depth chart here late in the fourth quarter, and why not? They have been in control ever since really early on in the third quarter.
See if in this last 30 seconds Furman can take a couple shots at the end zone, try to get some more points on the board for themselves.
Pressure just from fourth down linemen, and it's Justice Ajeek.
They do it.
Georgia Southern will improve to 5-0 in Southern Conference play. In all likelihood, will be number one for the sixth consecutive week when the polls come out in a couple of days. While Furman has some work to do, back-to-back losses for the Paladins drops them to an even 500 in the league. And they've got homecoming against Wofford next week. It doesn't get easier for Bruce Fowler and the Furman Paladins. So Georgia Southern gets six rushing touchdowns from five different players and dominate Furman 50-20. That's the final score. Be sure to join us next Saturday. We go to Elon. We get the Chattanooga Mocs and the Elon Phoenix, 3 o'clock Eastern time. Special thanks to the Southern Conference, Furman University, and Georgia Southern University. Thank you for joining us today for the SoCon Game of the Week. For Rashawn Ali, Stephanie Singleton, Doug Chapman, and our entire crew, I'm Darren Goldwater. Be sure to tune in next week to the SoCon Sports Network.